We return once again with another video to try and provide some help, some clarification, some calm down, some positivity. There's no question that the higher consciousness, call it whatever you like, call it the Holy Spirit if you like, is very much aware of the event horizon that is about to occur. To use a good term that's been suggested here, event horizon is a very good term. And I'm saying that May 27th, we're going to be aware the event horizon is going to begin. It's going to really become very noticeable July 24th. Something is going to happen July 24th of 2016. We're about ready to enter into this very intense event horizon. The Holy Spirit is extremely aware of it. And I want to tell you that the more we look into this, I think the calmer we will become. The Holy Spirit is pressuring me to look into this, and I'm saying, why? You know, but now I'm starting to see, hey, wait a minute. Maybe this is actually very helpful, and I want to focus on the periodicity of this event. There's no question now, and looking back, that one of our great Dharma, the Dharma Queen, Sri Sri Anandamayi, showed me in a dream exactly what's going to happen. She acted the whole thing out and showed me. She's very aware of it. Higher consciousness is aware of this situation. And in looking historically, the Holy Spirit says, look back historically and you can see that there has been a regular event horizon take place about every 3,600 years in this world. An event horizon is something that a constellation, a convergence of events happens such that it pretty much changes the world in all sorts of various ways. Very intense. And so we're in for another one now. Okay, fine. This is not a surprise to higher consciousness at all. Higher consciousness is absolutely aware there's these periodic event horizons here. Now, if they can share this with us, and if we are waking up to this, which we are, congratulations everybody who's waking up to this. This is a huge step. Super positive. So you should give yourself some praise and calm down and say, wow, I'm doing really great. I'm waking up to this. Not many are, but some are for sure. Now, if we can wake up to this, and if higher consciousness is informing us of all this, which it is, can't we extrapolate this with a good scientific mind saying, now, wait a minute. If there are other dwelling places, let's take the hypothesis, there are other civilizations in the cosmos, which Jesus and other teachers have made clear, there are. In fact, there's a massive amount of sentient life all over. Some of it's been there for a long time, all part of the cosmic dream. However, if we can wake up to this, cannot we at least theorize that there are others in the cosmos who are very clearly aware of this? And they say, oh yeah, planet Earth. Well, I guess the 3,600 year cycle of planet X / Nibiru complex. The planet X Nibiru complex is another term that someone suggested. I'm going to adopt this term. There's people who are doing some good work on this because we're not quite sure what to call it. Let's call it the planet X Nibiru complex. Is it a group of, you know, what is it? Is it a complex of some sort, right? So they say, of course they know about it. It's not any cosmic secret. The events of the cosmos, they say, of course it's a binary system. Of course there's this planet X Nibiru complex, because Earth call it. It comes through like this, and it's happened every 3,600 years, and in cosmic time, that's just a blink of an eye. So of course they're aware of it. Now, I go back to a dream I had where I was shown very, very graphically the incoming of rocks. And in history, there's been two other times in history, of recent history, of human civilization that have been particularly bad. And then this third time is the worst by far. And I fled from it. I had to travel very fast, but I was able to outrun the whole thing. And I found myself going to another place, and I have to say it's like Arizonaville, a reduced intensity zone. It was some other realm, you'd have to say, some dwelling place, some world, some realm that was really completely unaffected by what had taken place here, totally unaffected. And it's very important to hear this. I reach this place like a refugee fleeing this terrible catastrophe. And I came up, it was pictured in a dream like a resort, a hotel. And I came up to the resort desk and I said, look, I got to tell you, I really need help. I'm fleeing this horrible catastrophe. I'm looking for some place to stay. I mean, can you help me? And they said, of course. And I said, do you know what happened there, planet Earth? And they said, of course we know. I said, you really? They said, yeah, we know all about it. And we've planned, we knew what would happen. We knew that you would be seeking refuge here and others. And we've already planned to accommodate you. It's all planned in advance, all of this. And I was like really stunned. I said, wow. They said, yeah, our place is your place. This is your home. You can stay as long as you like. Enjoy it. You're totally welcome here. And I was quite stunned and shocked by this. And then I began to explore the place. And it was just gorgeous. It was just a fabulous place. I said, wow, what amazing hospitality. I said, will you honor my, you know, I was going to be staying in this the world there, but can we honor that I had reservations there, but can I have them here? And they said, of course we honor that. Of course we do. They were aware of the whole situation, and they had already prepared ahead of time to take in refugees. So what this indicates is that there are those in the cosmos, or in consciousness, I might say, however you want to talk about it, who most certainly are aware of what's going about to happen in this world, that, and to them it's like no big deal in terms of they're not shocked by it. So they seem to know that this is something that is just, you know, it's a feature that happens here on Earth, and they just plan ahead for it, and they're calm and relaxed. So this is what I'm seeing. The Holy Spirit has been telling me to dig into the past. See the periodicity of this, how it comes every regularly like this throughout history. And now connect this with, don't you think others are aware of this? I mean, we're waking up to it, right? Are we the smartest people on the block? Are there others who might be quite a lot more aware? And if so, you know, if we know a disaster's coming, don't you set up relief centers? Of course, they would do that. They would say, well, this is something we want to do. We're compassionate. We're in service to others. We set up a relief center. We take in refugees, and they get to stay there. As long as they like. I was told, as long as you like. So maybe things are not so dire after all. Jesus told us he would return at this time, the end of the age. And remember, he said that it's very important when you hear the seas roaring and the signs in the heaven and the seas roaring so, and the things that seem so terrible here that people are dying of fright. He says, stand up, lift up your head, because your salvation is at hand. So he tells us, don't worry at all. This is the time of your salvation, actually, from these troubles here in this world. So certainly Jesus was aware of all this, and he said he's going to prepare a dwelling place for us. Are we supposed, can we not at least hypothesize and maybe even theorize that this situation is well known in advance, how it plays out, because it's played out so many times before in history. And so they've made preparations, good preparations to help us out. So I don't feel so worried. I don't. I'm not panicking or, you know, agitated, you know, very much at all. Just like I say, well, this is great. However it plays out, you know, those who have spiritually prepared and are able to remain calm like this, you know, whatever is benevolent will happen. It's not all going to be awful. There's a benevolent side to the whole thing, which is more important. So focus on the benevolence. Now, so having said that, I have what I feel is what I call is a scientific mind. I love my mind the way it is now, and it's only going to get better. It's what I call is a true scientific mind, which is the willingness to dig into difficult problems that we're not sure. It's very fuzzy, and work through all that and gather evidence, weigh the evidence, come up with a hypothesis. First a suggestion, then see if it merits a hypothesis, and then keep working and then see if it merits to be a theory. This is true science, and I'm a generalist. I'm not one of these specialist scientists who focus narrowly in. I'm a generalist who's interested in the big picture, big questions, and it's very difficult to be a scientist because you're dealing with so much uncertainty, and it's difficult. You have to your life, your mind say, I don't know. It could be this. It could be that. I need more evidence, and you dig. And people think you're crazy, it's wasting your time, and they just want it just easy for them, and don't, you know, it's really, really rough to keep an open scientific mind and really weigh the evidence. So what I have done is I have gone through and done a massive effort throughout my whole life to gather as much evidence, relevant evidence as possible, under the suggestion that this is worthy to look at from higher consciousness. This feeling like this is very, very important to look at this. And then just weigh it. You know, justice is seen as a lady with a blindfold. You're supposed to just weigh impartially. So a scientist is supposed to just weigh the evidence that they have impartially and see, does it, this suggestion, merit a hypothesis or not? And so what I determine after weighing the evidence is I say it's deserving of a hypothesis. Let us hypothesize that there is some cyclical disturbance on this planet Earth. The evidence warrants that. I can tell you that. And I think I believe I've looked at the evidence in depth as well as anyone from many, many angles. It warrants a hypothesis saying this is possible. So what do you do when you have a hypothesis? What you do is you then gather additional evidence that are relevant to either prove or disprove the hypothesis, right? This is what scientists do. And they live in this nebulous gray area of uncertainty, right? And hypothesis is something that you put out there and you have to keep working on it. It's not yet a theory. It's not yet a theory, okay? It takes stronger evidence for something to be called a theory. Once you have a theory, then other people need to look at it and give strong evidence to disprove it, right? I mean, they can't just, you know, dismiss it, airily dismiss it like a lot of people are in this world right now who claim to be scientists, but they aren't scientists at all. They're not going about it in a scientific way at all. They're lazy knuckleheads in a lot of ways, actually. They haven't looked at it at all. I mean, you talk about a hatchet job. The Pravda of the New World Order is Wikipedia, and its page on Planet X is just a hatchet job, the worst hatchet job I've ever seen. It's just utterly ridiculous. This is not scientific. The people who are so-called debunking this are not scientists. Okay, they're not, because there is enough evidence to warrant a hypothesis, no matter what anyone's they say. I am absolutely sure of that. A hypothesis is not proven. It's not in the realm of theory. A theory is much stronger in saying that this is likely to happen. This is likely true. More likely than not, and therefore the theory stands until someone else comes up with a better theory to account for all the evidence. There is a massive amount of evidence that needs to be accounted for in some way, and this periodic disturbance is the best way that I have seen to account for this evidence. So now, but that's a hypothesis. So in order to be a theory, you need more evidence, and I'm aware of this. I try to be a very good scientist in this way. I'm like a spiritual scientist. You know, I bring spirit into the whole thing, spiritual truths also into the whole thing, and try, you know, just try and weigh, and try to be careful what I say, and go about it that way. Now, I've been looking at a lot of videos that people are posting. It's an amazing number of videos. People all over the world are trying to gather evidence on this, and it is tough to weed through all of this because there's a lot of yahoos out there who are getting lens reflections and, you know, and don't know what they're doing. But You know, if you've done a lot of work with photography, which I have, and video and all this stuff, you kind of know what a lens reflection is and parallax and all this kind of stuff. I mean, very keen about it. So we have a lot of practice. We're not all these novices, you know, knucklehead novices running around making all these amateurish mistakes. Sure, there's a lot of that out there, and there may even be some fraud out there. It's kind of like the crop circle people over in England. A couple fraudsters, you know, they'd stomp out a crop circle, a crude crop circle, and say, "You see, we admit we did it. That means all crop circles are fraudulent." You know, well, this is the most juvenile kind of logic. It's utterly unscientific logic. It's ridiculous to even consider such nonsense. The fact that some people may be photoshopping it or whatever, yeah, it doesn't disprove the other stuff. No, it just means that they're deceivers. That's all. And Wikipedia is just in on this deception cover-up game. They're really disgraceful, Wikipedia, in a lot of ways. Like I call it it's the modern Pravda. You know, it's a propaganda website in a lot of ways. So don't rely on Wikipedia for really important information. You know, it's very biased. It has its biases, to say the least. So if you really are science, go about scientifically, you're open mind. You look at this stuff. I look at this stuff. I say, well, okay, this one doesn't seem very. And I weigh it. You know, what is the credibility of all this? Now, I thought, what about the moon? Are they taking pictures of the moon? But I think that when the moon is real close to the sun on the horizon, you can't really see it. It catches reflected light from the sun, but when it's real near it, I don't think they're taking pictures of the moon. From all my experience with the moon and the sun and looking at the sky, which is a lot, I just don't think it's the moon. Okay, I don't. I don't think maybe a few, you know, but it just doesn't seem to add up. So there's something that people are taking pictures of that doesn't seem to be the moon and doesn't seem to be lens reflections. And there's such a variety around the world. You can't just write it all off as lens reflections or, you know, some just, you know, electronic anomaly or something. That really doesn't add up with what I'm seeing. The more recent pictures are much more compelling. There's definitely some sort of anomaly, seems to be an anomaly. So there's a lot of new weight coming in. That is you put on the scale. You put on the scale. A lot of it from the southern hemisphere. There's certain areas, and there's people are questioning why are important people going to the Antarctic, for instance. They say it's more visible down there. And someone had this science station webcam in Antarctica, and they caught something there that was quite extraordinary. I mean, there's a lot of people in Australia too. There are people taking stuff from webcams and from space cams, which are catching stuff that it really makes you stop and say, wow. A red complex, you know, the sky. Now, we have had trouble in the past with various websites and various people who've said that Nibiru, that the Planet X Nibiru complex is coming, and setting dates like 2003 is a very notorious situation. And then they claim, well, it did come, it's just hiding behind the sun, and all blah, 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 blah. Well, you know, Wikipedia used this to try to discredit everybody. Obviously, the cosmic mechanics are such that if something's orbiting and slingshots around the sun, it can't just stall out around the sun and stop. It couldn't have escape velocity to escape the sun. It would start orbiting around the sun then. It's ridiculous. Can't have something coming in and then just stalling out and just hanging motionless in the sky. I don't see how celestial mechanics could possibly account for that. So we may have gotten some. What they said is they told a white lie to get us ready ahead of time, so it would stir us up and get us focused on this. So they gave this early date that was they knew it wasn't true, and this is possible. This is possible. These folks are supposed to be Zeta Reticulans, you know, the ones with the big eyes and big heads and grays and lived underground for a long time. And they do have a penchant of lying, which they admit to. And they say they do it on purpose to get us going on stuff that we would otherwise procrastinate on. So I'm aware, very aware of this. That may be a case that they were telling a lie as far as the timing goes. That is possible, but they may have also fudged on other stuff. So, but there are many, 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 many people working on this from many angles. It's not just this one website, the Zeta Talk website. It's not just that. Wikipedia makes it seem like it all came from that. What a crock. I've been aware of this my entire life, starting and born with this knowledge in 1956. The idea that this just came to light with one lady's website back in 2000, 1990 something or whatever, is such a ridiculous statement. There have been people aware of this for a long time and trying to share this information. This just happened to get more notoriety, but that's ridiculous. So there are a lot of people who have been working on this and continue to work on it. So the evidence keeps coming in. Now I'm convinced that we're going to be hit by some rocks. What is causing these rocks to come in, I am not sure. But the Holy Spirit seems adamant that we're going to be hit by some rocks. This, and I believe, my whole life, I've felt 100% sure of this. It's coming, and it could be quite a bad hit by rocks coming in. Now, is this part of the Planet X Nibiru complex? It might be. It might be. I'm not yet convinced. I would say, it's. The evidence, if you weigh it, suggests a theory. It suggests a theory. I'm not quite ready to put it in the realm of theory yet. Certainly, the evidence strongly establishes a hypothesis of a periodic. The Sumerians call it the planet of the crossing, the planet that crosses us, and also a planet seems to have a cross with its moons forming a cross. Well, this seems to be what is showing up in the sky, the stuff that's been leaked or stuff that's been seen. A planet, something comes complex with some planets around it. I mean, satellites or moons around it. You might call it moons. Sorry, moons. And it crosses our orbit. So the ancients said that there's this planet of the crossing. Nibiru means planet of the crossing, a complex of some sort that crosses our orbital path and causes these bad disturbances. And they say that it's periodic. So they were certainly aware of it. That's why they gave it the name. So there's a lot of enough suggestion of evidence to say there's a definite hypothesis here that there is something that disturbs the solar system periodically, and is a troublemaker. And the Bible's revelation very clearly points out something that's the same that the Sumerians and Egyptians and ancient peoples pointed out, how it tends to rain this blood and turns the oceans to blood and rivers to blood. What would do that except iron oxide, right? Massive, and it's said that this Planet X Nibiru complex is shedding this iron oxide, and then they say that when it comes in, it's got these red wings. That's why they depict it as a planet with wings, as the magnetic, some sort of bow effect or some magnetism in some way. I mean, the cosmic effect of our solar system coming in tends to spread out the iron oxide like a pair of wings around this complex. And historically, they say that, I mean, the Egyptian plagues, they talk about it, how it turned everything to blood, all the rivers to blood, and terrible effects on the on this world. Well, what could turn our oceans, all the water on the planet, to blood, except massive inundation of some sort of dust, iron oxide dust, you might say, something like that, right? I don't know anything else that could really do that. So Revelation of the Bible certainly talks about a cosmic storms. Jesus said that the oceans would be roaring, I believe, so badly people would be fainting and dying out of fear. Well, this is more than just a tsunami somewhere. I mean, he seems to indicate that the oceans, just the totality of the oceans, will be vastly disturbed to an extent that we've unprecedented extent. What could cause that except some massive gravitational magnetic, pull or a pole shift or something like that? So you start adding everything up. All the intuitives, which I'm an intuitive and came into this world with knowledge about all this, you start adding all that up and you have a hypothesis. So those people who are just saying, "I debunked it," they're not going about it scientifically. They're having a knee-jerk reaction based on wishful thinking about it. They haven't debunked it. This is not a hypothesis that has been debunked at all. You have to come up with some alternative explanation, you know, for all this. And a lot of us, like the pseudoscience I was taught in school, you know, it's not, the scientists aren't trying to explain history. They're trying to explain it away, okay? Because they don't want it to be the way that it's been. They say, gee, I hope the future isn't like this, so let's just pretend that it won't be. And they take this kind of Christian concept that we think that the wrath of God has been appeased by the sacrifice of Jesus, believing that God is this cosmic puppet master who brings about this wrathful stuff if we sin against God's laws or something, which Jesus has told us very clearly this is not God at all. But they had the barbaric misinterpretation of Christianity is this wrathful God and controlling the cosmos, sending these punishments to us. So they think that the sacrifice of Jesus has appeased God's wrath, so it won't happen again. It's finished. Never again will it happen. Of course, what do they say? Jesus said, the world will not be, or well, Noah was told the rainbow. Said, oh, the world will never be, God said, I'll never destroy the world by flood again. And everyone goes, oh, aren't you so wonderful, God? He said, the next time it's going to be by fire. Well, wait a minute, you know, that doesn't sound like appeasement of God's wrath. Next time it's by fire. Well, you know, all these stones coming in, burning everywhere, and high energy particles and magnetic interaction and stuff. It could set the world on fire, heat it up or something. So, anyway, the Christianity we've gotten is in part a barbaric interpretation, a pagan barbaric misinterpretation of it all. And there's another Christianity that I'm part of that has a much more wider viewpoint of the whole thing and sees it differently. It sees this as a cosmic dream and does not blame God for the troubles of this cosmos at all. It's our own dream of conflict, trying to buy our way out of reality, actually. You know, Adam and Eve fell asleep and started dreaming. Well, they dreamed a cosmic dream is what really happened. It's just a way of depicting it. So I'm not blaming God for anything. There's nothing, we don't need to appease God's wrath in any way, actually. So they wanted to believe that none of this past ever happened. So the science that we grew up with was basically saying, folks, it's all just Darwinianism. That's it. And it's just a slow, gradual snail's pace of just peaceful, calm, you know, hundreds of millions of years of slow change, and don't worry, everything is just going to be fine for the next millions of years, you know, and God put us here to be custodians of this world, and everything will be blissful and peaceful and calm here, and just wonderful, no troubles. Nice corporate spiel here, right? You know, in other words, be good little peasants. Don't get worried. This is just nonsense. Most science that we grew up with was just trying to explain away the past instead of explaining it. It just lies. I mean, really, when I was young, I just said, this is all, I knew, 100% sure, I said, this is all lies. They're absolutely lying. And I tried to tell people, I got so frustrated in school with people. I said, you believe this? This is a lie. This isn't history at all. They're making this up. They're trying to explain away history, not explain it. And so you still have these dinosaurs trying to explain away history when the evidence that has been pouring in, you have to be a moron to buy the old spiel about Darwinism as far as this just gradual, you know, no punctuated parts of history at all. History is punctuated. You could say it's punctuated evolution, but it is severely punctuated with event horizons. Most certainly it is. And so history continues. It keeps repeating itself. So the dinosaurs are losing the day on this one. At least we hope they are. They're just so far. They're flat earthers, essentially, at this point. Those who claim to be scientists and think that Darwinism is still... was that only that's what happens, and there's no punctuated evolution, there's no event horizons, there's no disturbances of the earth and periodic cycles, and none of this. You know, they're flat earthers at this point. You know, kind of be pitied, actually. The evidence doesn't back them up. History is a rough story, and we don't want to believe that. And the idea is that somehow God's been appeased, so it's all going to be smooth from now on. It is a fairy tale. It's wishful thinking at best. Wishful thinking at best. And of course, we all want to believe that. I want to believe it. Everybody wants to believe it. But that's not being a good scientist. Science is not built on wishful thinking of how you want things to be. It's taking the actual facts and developing a theory that accounts for the facts instead of trying to explain away the facts the way you want them to be. Like, instead of building your own theory of everything's perfect in the past, as everything's been fine, and then insisting that whatever facts don't fit it, you just, you know, brush them under the carpet, sweep them under the carpet. That's not science. Yeah, there's a lot of bad names for that. It's self-deception, you might say. So we have to look and be aware and not stick our head in the sand. And one thing that I really take umbrage at is the idea that the ancients were some kind of just totally stupid psychotics and they didn't know what's going on. This is ridiculous. If you look at the infrastructure and the public works and the overall, the ancients were not nearly as dumb as we like to think they are. The reason why they tried to picture them as all these primitive savages who didn't know anything was because the stuff that they were finding, that they were saying, they didn't want to believe in it. Because they're saying, wow, you know, the earth really gets hit by bad stuff. And so they said, they're just stupid. They're making it up. We can't rely upon what they tell us. Yeah, well, this is terrible science, isn't it? So we've gotten a lot of really, really bad science here in this world. And some of us are trying to correct this. Thank God for that. And don't worry about the elites and all this stuff, you know, the demagogues were getting people angry about it. Just, you know, it's about you. It's about you and your salvation. It's about each of us and our salvation is what it's about. So let the elites deal with their salvation. Let's deal with our salvation. And not get into any anger or concern, really. And just look at it in a calm way. If you want to be scientific, you need to remain calm so you can really assess things appropriately. You can't be projecting your emotions on the facts and then think that you're going to get an objective read of the facts. It doesn't happen that way. So you have to be kind. You have to be benevolent. You have to just simply say, I will go where the evidence leads me without emotions telling me where I have or should go, right? The way I want it to be. And again, none of us want troubles here. Nobody does. Other than maybe some who want to seize, you know, some sort of demagogic dictatorial power. They love crises. But most people, they don't. And we certainly don't want crises here. So we're not trying to manufacture evidence. We're just saying, you know, there's a hypothesis here. So let's look at the hypothesis without getting tricked into, you know, people trying to, you know, joust with you over, you know, quibbles and details and stuff. Hypothesis doesn't rise or fall on intricate details necessarily. A theory needs more details or more solid empirical evidence, you might say, but not a hypothesis. So, you know, there's a lot of people who think they're hotshot scientists who are really not. They're just posers. A lot of people love to say they have a scientific mind because that's a very, very high honor and prestige. Really, scientists have been honored throughout history, have they not? Because it's difficult to have a good scientific mind. It's a very advanced mind in some ways, and people would love to claim they have a scientific mind, and so they love to pose as if, you know, they do have it by debunking, say, oh no, that's ridiculous, forget about it, people, you can trust my scientific mind. And they don't really have scientific minds at all. They're posers. You know, they haven't done the hard work. Those who've done the tough, really tough work, you know, they know. The people who've done all the core sampling and all the really intricate, difficult work, they're not going to have their work brushed aside by somebody who says, nothing to see here, you know. They're going to say, wait a minute. We've done it and retested, and others have tested and retested, and we've built this database of this various parameters, and we have discovered that you know, there is this periodicity, and stuff has happened volcanically, and so we're not exactly sure how to explain it, but certainly stuff has happened. Now, if is there some periodic perturber of the solar system, that certainly is a hypothesis that could account for it. It could account for it, absolutely. We see volcanism. Now, to be fair and impartial with scientific mind has to be, and by the way, a really good scientific mind often becomes mystical and begins to be aware of the real truth of the situation, because it can lead to that. Like Einstein was very much open to higher spiritual truths, for instance. A lot of great scientists have been very open to that, and they realize, you know, hey, there's higher truths. This may very well all be a dream, actually. And it is actually a dream, whatever that means. People have a hard time understanding that. It's not what we think it is. Let's put it that way. So, let's see if I can pick up the thread. So a lot of people who are debunking it, you know, they're not debunking it at all. Not at all. We're not making any effort to explain, well, what explains all this periodicity? Now, what I was going to say was, there's this basic, some people are claiming, well, look, there's this huge uptick in earthquakes, seismic activity, climate change, volcanism. All these changes are what the ancients used to point out to. The ancients pointed out, when this perturber gets close, you will notice it years in advance by the changes on the planet of volcanism, earthquakes, droughts. And the Bible says that there will be many droughts, severe droughts in many places, plagues, more earthquakes, all, you know. So the Bible literally tells us that as the end of the age gets closer, the earth will go through these pangs, you know, leading up to the tribulation. Very clear about it. So many are looking into this and saying, okay, and they're keeping track. Some people have earthquake sites and volcanism sites and extreme weather and all this stuff. And they're saying, look, it's getting insanely worse. It's like 100 times worse than it used to be, and like this. Okay, but to be honest, to be fair about it, let's keep in mind that the reporting that we have now and the awareness, everybody's got smartphones, webcams. Whatever happens anywhere in the world, somebody's reporting and posting on YouTube or a website or something, or keeping track of it. 1,000 years ago, almost none of this was happening. You get an earthquake in Lisbon, you know, and he wipes out Lisbon and stuff. That spreads. Some people eventually find out about that in Europe. But the stuff that happened around the world, nobody even knew about it. Most people didn't know about it at all. But now, you know, if somebody sneezes, everybody knows about it. So to say that there's been this massive uptick in all this stuff, you'd have to say there's been a massive uptick in all the reporting of everything that happens here. Now, does that account for the discrepancy that people are claiming between now and previously? Not exactly. Not exactly. Because we have been keeping records for a while. And there does seem to be an uptick, and certainly there is a warming. We know that. There does seem to be a warming. Now, is this a real trend, or are we just going through a couple years of heat? There are a lot of droughts. There have always been a lot of droughts in the world, right? I mean, famines and stuff that not aware, so aware of. There's more people now, so impacts more people. But the ice melting, the permafrost, well, that is something that you would say is a big change. So you have to say there are significant changes taking place. It may not be as great as some are trumpeting because of the you know, just the almost immeasurable greater reporting of all everything that's happening on the planet, geophysically and all, and every, you know, huge reporting change. So you have to weigh that in the situation. But I would say that those who claim that there is an uptick, well, okay. Earthquakes and diverse, well, there's always earthquakes in many places. In the Pacific, volcanism, always been a lot of volcanism, but maybe there is an uptick, maybe there is. And weather-wise, different extreme weather, there does seem to be some uptick, you know, going on. There seems to be some intensity going on. Now, if we measure the other planets of the solar system, we do find, at least on our measurements, that there are drastic changes taking place, at least on a short-term basis. We haven't been measuring them for that long, right? So if you put all that together, a hypothesis is suggested that there is something causing the solar system to go through changes, and the Earth is certainly going through some changes. That's a hypothesis. I think it's a justified hypothesis. I don't think it goes into the realm of a theory yet. This evidence on its own doesn't justify saying there's a definite theory. The hypothesis is that there's this binary twin star that is gotten close to our solar system. It tends to kind of go in its own, you know, I mean, the sun is moving, everything is moving in space, and this brown dwarf tends to move. It gets, sometimes it's closer to the sun, sometimes it's far away, and when it gets closer, it tends to produce this effect on the planet. Or it could be when this Planet X Nibiru complex gets closer, which makes more sense, because listen to this. If they say that this our brown dwarf twin star couldn't possibly have a short-term oscillation close to us, it would almost have to be very long-term. This is what scientists are saying. Well, if Planet X Nibiru complex was orbiting the brown dwarf, and the brown dwarf is way far away from us, vastly far away from us, in its kind of oscillation, then there's no way in the world that the Planet X Nibiru complex could ever get close to us, except when the brown dwarf got close to us. And if that's every 26 million years, we couldn't have this 3,600 year periodicity. It'd be impossible, scientifically impossible. The other theory is that this Planet X Nibiru complex is orbiting both the sun and the brown dwarf, or is orbiting just the sun and the brown dwarf. The reason why it has a long elliptical orbit is that the brown dwarf is influencing its orbit. Okay, we used to think there's no long-term orbits, then Hale-Bopp came, the comet, and we realized there are long-term orbits. So it could be that it's just going around the sun, but being influenced by the brown dwarf. But it really could not be a planetary system of the brown dwarf. Otherwise, you couldn't have 3,600-year periodicness unless the brown dwarf came close every 3,600 years, which is, you know, it's possible, but I'd say that's improbable. Very improbable, actually. That would mean it's really not that far away. That's not, you know, so that's kind of been pushed aside, like, that's not very likely. So we're kind of doing good science here and ruling out some stuff. So it could be that this Planet X Nibiru complex actually causes changes in the solar system, or it could be that the brown dwarf is close and is causing this system-wide changes throughout the whole solar system. And this would be what's called the true end of an age. We've told the whole solar system is going to change. This is something the mystics have told us. At the end of this age, this is the end of a long cycle. And some have said 26,000 years, some have said 26 million years. But they kind of say that this is the whole solar system is going to undergo fundamental change now. So the brown dwarf may be near at this point. But that doesn't mean that the Planet X Nibiru complex is orbiting the brown dwarf. As I said, that would only bring it through once every 26,000 or 26 million years, which the historical record does not show that. It shows every 3,600 years. Some say it's 360 years. I'm not sure the record really shows that. Okay, I don't think there's strong evidence to suggest it's 360 years. Again, that's sort of on the fringes. That's more on the fringe sort of thing. I mean, I'm not ruling it out completely, but it's somewhat fringe at this point. There's a lot of fringe ideas out there. You don't want to get all confused about it. Now, if the brown dwarf were getting real close at this point, one of its closest periods, it would certainly have knocked a lot of rocks. You'd think of it as knocked a lot of rocks from the Kuiper Belt and Oort cloud towards us. And now here's another thing. Are we having more meteorites? Or are we having more reporting? Because if a meteorite falls anywhere these days, excuse me, somebody sees it, somebody reports it, somebody, you know, tells these databases and they flag it. That didn't used to be the case. So are we getting more of this, or is just more reporting? It's a good question. Difficult to answer that one. But, you know, you could suggest we're getting more. I don't know if it's a hypothesis that for sure we're getting more. Maybe it rises to the level of a hypothesis, you could say, which warrants attention. It could develop into a theory. It could, if you do good science, which includes intuition, a lot of scientists have gotten their biggest breakthroughs through intuition. And Newton's taking a snooze and an apple hits him on the head, supposedly. I mean, someone dreamed of DNA, or what was it, in a dream, you know, or benzene ring or something like that, a snake eating its tail. The great, great scientists actually have dreams, and they get stuff from their dreams that it all suddenly clarifies. I mean, I certainly get a lot from my dreams. I pay great attention to them because I realize there's something that knows what's going on a lot better than surface consciousness. A lot better. That's interesting. And Sri Sri Anandamayi, also knows Anandamayi Ma, but she said, don't call me Ma. I'm not really your mother. I'm a little girl. She thinks very simply. She always insisted that when I said that Jesus is coming, the Son of God's coming, she goes, yeah, but I'm coming too. I'm a twin. She'd say, there's a twin coming also. It's twins. And I drove me crazy for years and years and years. And she insisted that twins, she said the real situation is twins. I said, what are you talking about? I didn't have any idea of a brown dwarf binary star system at that point. Not many people did. And now I'm looking back and said, oh my God. She was adamant that we live in a binary star system. And this twin, it's seemingly, she may have been saying this twin is approaching very close. And wow. And I just, you know, this has helped so much to clear up, because that really drove me crazy. I just could not figure out what in the heck is the obsession with twins. There was just this massive obsession. And it's, it has to do with the twin binary system, two stars in our solar system. A brown dwarf is not cold necessarily. It just hasn't ignited thermonuclearly as a star has, but it's still giving out. Could be giving out tremendous heat. It just hasn't risen to the level of was it nuclear fission or fusion or whatever it is the sun is stars are doing. So it's still, you know, power could be very powerful magnetically, gravitation, every which way powerful. It's just it's not giving off the same light as a star like our sun. So we have gotten very strong, I have gotten very strong warnings from great spiritual teachers about this. I've gotten unbelievably strong indications from the Holy Spirit about this. So that has to be factored in. If you really want to be scientific, you know, you can't just limit everything to, you know, knucklehead concrete empiricism. But we may be getting to that point now. It might be a little late for some, but these pictures that people are taking, they make you say, whoa, wait a minute. Whoa. What is going on here? So many, from so many different people. This is the thing. And the thing also is they're a lot better than they used to be. It used to be that it seems like, that's not very convincing. Now, it's looking more and more convincing. And you're getting stuff that does not look at all like it's faked on After Effects or, you know, Photoshop After Effects or whatever. I was an expert in both Photoshop and After Effects, and I can tell you a lot of this stuff, I don't believe it is faked. There could be some good fakes for sure, but a lot of this stuff, like just from webcams, from scientific research stations, it's just, they just put it up on their website and people are grabbing this, and then later on they take it down. And if you look at the area from Orion or wherever this complex is supposed to be coming from, the coordinates, the people saw something there, and very clearly in the sky map of Google Sky Map, and they gave the coordinates out. And lo and behold, next time they go into the sky map, that whole area is just a blacked out. And they asked Google about this, and Google said, oh, that's just a stitching issue we're having. Yeah, right. Well, how come it showed up before? Now you have a stitching issue exactly where supposedly this complex is coming in, which was visible in sky map. So stuff like this, you have to factor in the cover-up of this. This is very important scientifically. Is there a big cover-up going on? Okay, so if there's this intense cover-up going on by the elites, you have to then factor that into the hypothesis very strongly too, because they would not be doing that if there was nothing to see. But the amount of cover-up that has been going on is quite amazing, actually. There was some space camera, from Soho, that clearly showed what you would say would be this complex and then it was taken down. Now, you know, could it be Photoshop? Yeah. But if you add all this up, I don't think all of it is being faked. So then you'd have to say, well, maybe the other stuff also may not be faked as well. And, you know, that's why it's difficult to be a scientist. There's a lot of fakery throughout history, and scientists have had to dig through all the deception. Historically, there's always been deception. People don't want stuff to be discovered. You find that out. So it's a headache being a scientist and really digging for the truth here. It's very difficult. Now, it's supposed to come in from the southern hemisphere. This is what was shown to me in a dream. It's what people are saying. And Jesus says it'll sneak up on us like a thief in the night. We won't have hardly any time to prepare at all. It'll come in, you know, we won't even see it coming, basically. This is what we've been told historically, historical record. It's very difficult to even see it coming. Most people, they'll sneak up on you like a thief in the night. Jesus is very adamant about this. He said, prepare ahead of time with faith. Okay. Don't be the doubting Thomas, Jesus said. Blessed are those who believe without the concrete evidence. Right? Then Thomas went up to him and asked, is that you? He said, I won't believe it's you until I feel your side and all this stuff. And then he said, okay, now I believe in Jesus. Blessed are those who believe without this type of direct evidence. So what he's saying is, you may not have this empirical concrete evidence ahead of this crossing, this trouble. And so you have to have some faith in a hypothesis, in a theory that, you know, preparation might be a good idea. Some sort of spiritual preparation, however you see preparation. In fact, he said it would be a very good idea. So we can't really just easily brush off the wisdom of the ancients. Anyone who does so is quite a fool. And we can't easily brush off all the evidence that is present right now. That'd also be pretty foolish. Yes, there are some fools, there are a lot of fools out there who just, you know, want to get views on their videos, etc. But, you know, the kids having fun and kind of all freaked out and stuff. But that's not the whole picture by any means. And again, you have to just put all the evidence on the scales and see how they weigh out in your mind. And they weigh out in such a way as you say, we've got a hypothesis here, and we're leaning towards a theory. There is certainly momentum towards a theory here. And we may have a theory by, what, June 24th? That's possible. We may have a theory, which means it's you know, there's a strong likelihood it's true, unless some other explanation explains it all better, explains the evidence better. You can't just say, no, you have a theory. You can't just say, forget it, it's stupid, I'm not going to pay attention. You have to come up with some theory that explains it better. Right? That's what science does. Science, you know, you publish it and you have enough to people accept as a theory. Well, maybe someone will come along later and give better theory. And then eventually, you know, goes over to that. That's just science. That's okay. Science is not supposed to take it personally. And of course, many, many theories have been improved upon throughout history. And some even, some changed, fundamentally changed. They know this wasn't accurate. Here's a better theory to explain it. But they really haven't, you know, come up with a better theory to explain the evidence, really. They just ignore the evidence and then come up with some theory that agrees with their ignored evidence. They have some, you know, it's not a theory yet, I would say, because there's you know, as far as careful measurements of everything, you know, there seems it would be some gravitational, you know, disturbance if this was happening and various things. Well, that's sort of in a gray area also, actually. How accurate are their measurements? How legitimate is all that? This is, and scientists are going back and forth on this, you know, Planet Nine, this brown dwarf also. They're saying, you know, is it there? Is it not there? Is it what is it really? And so, you know, it's still in this somewhat fuzzy area. But the photographic evidence and video evidence is mounting. It is mounting. It's in that gray area between a hypothesis and a theory. It's but I'd say some rocks were going to get hit by rocks. I don't know what it would necessarily, what's causing the rocks to come in, but I feel the Holy Spirit is adamant about this. We're going to get hit by some rocks, from whatever cause. We don't have to know what the cause is in order to get hit by rocks. Let's keep that in mind. That's another scientific truth. Just because we don't know the cause of something doesn't mean there won't be an effect. Some people are so stupid. They say, "Well, that's ostrich in the head sand." I mean, if you say, "Well, you know, I just don't know what's caused this, therefore it can't happen. If it's not in the Yellow Pages, it doesn't exist." I mean, this is ridiculous. And a lot of people think they're scientists by claiming this. Well, if you can't prove that there's a cause of this, then it can't happen. No, it just means maybe I don't know the cause of it. That ignorance doesn't mean that something doesn't exist. And we were ignorant that the Earth was a globe. Does that mean it was flat? No, it means that we were ignorant of it. It was still round. So just because we're ignorant of a cause doesn't mean that there's no effect from a cause that we're not yet aware of what it is. This is just ABC, just basic. I find that people, so many people in this world are just very lacking in a basic scientific mind, of reasonable mind. They're just so deficient. It's extraordinary. And yet those who are not deficient, you could tell. It's obvious, right? Because they can handle this. They can handle they're flexible enough to say, "Yeah, that's obviously stupid. We can't determine a cause, so therefore there can't possibly be any sort of effects from an indeterminate cause. What do you mean?" Or we don't know what to call the cause. We don't have a label for it, so nothing can happen. This is wishful thinking. It's not science. So we may not know what can cause, maybe just real random rocks happen to come in, because that happens to be the time for that to happen. You know, is it a periodic thing or just a, you know, one-off thing, an anomaly sort of thing? You know, well, whatever. But my information has it that we're a couple of rocks are, you know, we're going to get some debris coming into this planet that is going to be significant debris. All right, space debris, significant. It'll be an attention getter, to say the least. And but you know, that's the very least. The other evidence I have is that it could be very, very significant. So from that, you could posit, you know, you could suggest, you know, what the cause might be. Could it be a brown dwarf that's comes close to us and pushes the rocks in? Could it be a Planet X Nibiru complex coming through the tail of that, the junk, all the space junk on the tail, and, you know, it's crossing our planet of the crossing, which causes so many headaches in history that they've recorded this. If you're really keen, you can tell the difference between real bright people in the past and the ones that weren't bright, just as you can now. It seems to be that there's always seems to be very bright people. And the very bright people of the past clearly indicate there's a troublemaker that comes through the solar system. It's just the way around it. And sure, they try to appease it and try whatever. I mean, wouldn't you do that? I mean, you do some sort of ghosting. I mean, you're not gonna just sit here. Humans tend to not just sit here and take it. They try to do something about it. And if you're talking about a cosmological problem like this, we're gonna dream up some sort of ritual to try and control this. For sure, we will. And I say that the Eucharist is such a ritual. The sacrifice of Jesus was a wishful thinking sort of situation, thinking that this appeased God because we were giving to God what is most pleasing to God. So God would be so happy with us. He'd say, okay, I'm calling off the orbit of Nibiru. I'm calling that off now. No more. It's not coming through anymore. And, you know, all sorts of religion, all sorts of stuff would crop up. Ghost dances of saying we do this dance and we're invulnerable. We do this ritual, we're invulnerable. We're going to do that. Our minds are such that when we're traumatized and stuff, bad stuff happens like this, we try to come up with a remedy. So you have to look historically. Have people tried to come up with remedies for something truly terrible? And yes, indeed, they have. And so this also points to the fact there must be something terrible. Otherwise, they wouldn't have come up with these crackpot remedies, you know, really. Those wouldn't do it. It doesn't make any sense at all, actually. But ancient history, the remedies they've come up with only make sense if they're pointing to something that really, really nasty that they're trying to get rid of somehow through some sort of wishful, magical, pseudo-spiritual activity. And you know the history, repent, 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 repent. God's always sending prophecy. Look, if you repent, this won't happen to you. If you repent, this won't happen to you. So there's this idea that we can control the cosmos based on our repentance or not, you know, how we act. Now, this is not entirely crackpot, actually, because this whole cosmos is just our dream of arrogance. So if we start shedding these layers of arrogance, which we call the ego, shedding the layers of this ego, if we start doing that, we can alter events in the dream. We can decide, we don't need that. That was just our own arrogance trying to stir up the purchase price of trying to help us suffer so we can get free, believe we can get free, buy ourselves free from freedom, essentially. And then we realize, oh, that's stupid. We don't really need that. Then, of course, we can alter a dream. I've had this in my dreams before where something bad was happening, and I realized that, you know what, I have power over this dream. I believe I have power over this. And that completely flipped the script of the entire dream, consciously did it. Well, that shows us. And everything changed. Drastic, catastrophic conditions suddenly vanished when I had enough awareness and conscience to say, hey, wait a minute, I'm the one who's dreaming this dream. I can change the dream any which way I want it to change. And literally, then the dream just changed like that. We can do that. We can do that. So Christianity is not, you can't say it's completely crackpot. You cannot say these things are crackpot, actually. It's a blend. It's a kind of a blend, because we're not so good at changing the dream yet. So this other stuff is worked into it, but bad in the back of our minds, we're saying, you know, that there is some way, right? That we get, then we know there's some way, but we may not be finding the right way to do it. So again, you look really keenly at ancient religion and history, and you have to conclude these people were very, very, very adamant about they needed to find some way to get on the good side of the cosmos, because it kept knocking the heck out of us, and we needed to really have some way to control it. And they set about trying to find ways to control it. Now, if the cosmos was just this beautiful, harmonious Garden of Eden, we wouldn't do that. There is no way you could, unless we were just completely psychotic, fundamentally psychotic, I mean, but even that would not necessarily account for it. This is very purposeful. It's more than just a random psychosis. It's very purposeful and directed and intentional and determination and all this stuff. The best Occam's razor, the best explanation is that it has to do with you know, traumas that we've experienced here, and a desperate feel that we need to be able to control the cosmos to avoid just getting clobbered. The fear is tremendous around this. If it was a Garden of Eden, you just wouldn't have this tremendous fear of the cosmos, for one thing. Why would he ever dream up, oh yeah, we get clobbered? If there was no clobbering ever, no evidence of any clobbering. We just, you know, it's ridiculous to think that this is what we'd come up with and for our amusement. I don't know. That's a pretty unlikely explanation. I mean, you could posit that explanation, but it's very, very unlikely given the constellation of evidence. You'd have to say that's kind of just like you know, one of these silly plausibilities that you do just to kind of play scientist or something. Doesn't really align very, very well at all. Now, these people back, ancient people, were scared of stuff that happened, and they said, wow, how can we make sure this doesn't happen again? And they came up with all sorts of rigmarole that they hoped would work. And then they got very upset if anybody said it doesn't work. They'd get angry, say, no, everybody has to believe it. You know, if everybody believes it, it'll work. Well, we know this is somewhat of a sign of wishful thinking, right? When you have something very flimsy, you feel that, well, the reason why it doesn't work is everybody doesn't believe in it. But if everybody believed in it, then it would work. This is kind of a sign, like, uh-oh, you know, this is a warning sign. And so some of these efforts have been that way, very dogmatic, saying, look, we'll be saved from God's wrath if everybody on the planet agrees to do what we tell them to do. There's some grain of truth in this, and that the consciousness here, we all decided we don't need this dream to be the way it is. We don't need it to be catastrophic. It very well, then the dream would shift and we wouldn't be. So that there is that element to it. But again, I think they're sort of playing both sides to the situation. I don't think they quite understand clearly enough what's going on. So it's a six of one, half a dozen of the other. There's sort of both elements there, which makes it difficult to deal with, doesn't it? You can't just dismiss the whole thing, really. But the facts are that not everybody on the planet is going to agree with this. So it's not going to happen right now. So you better come up with something better, right? There's no way you can look at the world right now and believe everybody's going to have this great faith and we're all going to see it's all a dream. We can shift the dream and do it. There may be some people, but the majority of people, I mean, if you just look at all the comments on the internet and just take the temperature of the minds of around the world, there's a lot of cracked pots out there, to say the least. And so people are in no mood to jump on that bandwagon. I've tried my whole life to get people to go in that direction. You know, it's like Jonah and Nineveh saying, repent, otherwise you're going to be really just wiped out. And they repented. Somehow he got through to them. But I don't think Jonah's getting through to this world, the mindset of this world at this point. And the mainstream media is doing their very best to make sure that this doesn't get through to anyone. And they're such fools anyway. Who would believe them one way or the other? You know, if they said it was true, who would believe them, really? It's an exercise in control. What the media really likes is they like to see how much control that can they have. They're fascinated by their capacity. This propaganda media throughout its history has drawn people who are fascinated about, how much can we really control people psychologically through the media. This is something that they're fascinated by it, and so they try to see, like an experiment to them, like a scientific experiment to them, to see, you know, how far can we go. And they don't seem to realize that there's such thing as the public good and compassion, and it's being what we might say too cold-blooded, sort of going overboard scientifically. You know, it's like the Nazis doing all these experiments and say, well, science, we're doing this sort to get scientific data. Well, you know, the scientist has to have a conscience too. Don't forget that. So the media should not be playing, you know, games with people in this way, of how well can we control you, and how much can we deceive you, and how, you know, how much can we lead you, and how much influence can we have? They have a higher calling which they're neglecting for the most part. So it's just people have had to go around them. They become an obstacle to getting the truth. They're not reporting it. I had someone, an eyewitness that went down to New Orleans after Katrina, and he told me, he saw it with his own eyes and talked to the people down there, and they said that only one ward flooded. I think it was, nine? Ward number nine, something like that. If so, that's an interesting correlation with planet number nine, that they think that is a brown dwarf. But there's some ward down there. It flooded pretty badly, okay. But the other ones didn't flood. And he went around the city and said, hey, you know, what we got in the media was a lie. We were severely lied to. And the people down in New Orleans said the same thing. They said, and the press, they said, the president lied. These people have lied about it for their political gain and to see, you know, how well can we tell big lies to people, actually. And I think the media is sort of in this game of thinking how important they are, of seeing, you know, what can we get away with? And they seem to be out of control. You know, just, they've lost the respect of people, rightfully so. So you have this overall situation, zeitgeist right now in the world, which can be very agitating to people. So what I want people to do is I want them to calm down here. First of all, higher consciousness knows everything that's going on. So we're never far away from knowing what's really going on at all. It's right there within us. There are indications that the elites know what's going on, and you can, you know, kind of read from that. There are indications that others who are intelligent mind have some idea of what's going on. Grace of God certainly knows what's going on. The great gold standards, the Dharma kings and queens, have given very strong indications they know what's going on. You could say Jesus most certainly indicated he's aware of what's going on. So you put all that together. And you have to say, well, wait a minute, okay, God knows what's, let's say God knows, use a term, God knows what's going on here. Let's not anybody panic or, about this, no. Let's have faith in awareness and in grace of God. Let's have faith that, you know, there's a remedy of some sort, Don't waste any time on witch hunts at this time. Don't waste time on witch hunts. Now, what about the issue of chemtrails, for instance? This is very interesting. A lot of people now are saying they're deliberately spraying chemtrails in the morning and evening and to try and prevent us from seeing the second sun, they call it. It may not be the second sun. It may be Planet X Nibiru complex, actually. The brown dwarf is likely too far away for us to see it, actually. But whatever, they're spraying the skies to prevent the public at large from seeing this. Now, this is a very interesting hypothesis, isn't it? I haven't followed this up enough yet. Nobody seems to be quite sure why are they spraying the skies like this. Now, they'll be spending all day spraying it, but what happens? Well, but it comes evening time when the sun is setting, the sky is all cloudy, isn't it? And they tend to do this over population centers where people are a lot. And it's obvious the crisscross pattern, they're producing this cloud cover. Why? And so some have said that it's to, in general, try to distract people away from this, believe they can't, there's nothing to see there, I don't see anything, I can't. This is a hypothesis. Pretty interesting, huh? The elites, they're building all these underground installations all over the world. Are they believing in a thermonuclear war? Well, I don't think the elites want to start a thermonuclear war. They're into control. They're on ego trips. If there's a thermonuclear war, there may be no more people in the world, maybe no more planet. They don't want that. They want to be people that they rule over. And they want a healthy planet, actually. They don't want this planet ruined. They're on an ego trip. You got to understand this. they're not Dr. Strange. They're trying to trying to destroy the world. They may be causing problems inadvertently. You know, just become their greed or whatever. But humans in general are consuming so much. But the elites, they love the power trip. They love it. You don't think the politicians want people looking up to them and No, they don't want everybody to be wiped out. They may want a great population reduction, but they certainly don't want a nuclear winter, a radioactive world that is just devastated and destroyed. No, because how can they come out from their underground caverns, installations, and rule over the Happy Kingdom with them being these divine elites? Though they love being looked up to as if they were divine, as if they're divine. They're on this megalomaniac ego trip, a lot of them. So I don't think the elites are planning some sort of thermonuclear war. I don't think they see that in their advantage at all. That's stupid. You start a war with the United States, right? There's going to be a retaliation. It's going to end up into just this global holocaust. I don't think that's anybody really wants that. Now, another issue is, in this dream I had, I saw after this great tribulation, the world was kind of reformed in a way. It really was, went through an intense geological reformation. I saw all these people coming out from underground. I realized that they had been underground and weathering this storm. And they had prepared ahead of time. But what I noticed was the peculiar nature of these people as they came out from underground. Very peculiar. And I'll tell you what I noticed. It was striking. They all looked like superheroes. They had these costumes on. And I said, they were very muscular and buff as far as, like, you know, accenting, like they're workout nuts. And like they've been using steroids, shaping themselves physically to appear very imposing and strong. And plus they're wearing these like superhero costumes of some sort, like Marvel Comics or something. Like they look like comic book characters. They really did. And I remarked on this. I was there observing all this. I said, holy cow, what is this? Who are these people? But I looked carefully at them. They seemed humanoid. They really did. But I said, what have they been doing to themselves? Well, if you were living underground for a prolonged period of time, what would you be doing? I'll tell you what I'd be doing. I'd probably be working out in the gym and exercising and keeping myself super fit. It's something to do, right? If you're living underground. And furthermore, I'd be thinking about when I come back above ground and there's all these survivors, how do I want them to view me? Now, these elites are on a big power trip and they want to continue to be looked up to as if they're more important than everybody else. So if they come up from under the ground, how are they going to look? Are they going to look all kind of weak and tired? No, they want to come out looking powerful and strong, and they want to fit some sort of mythic imagination they think people might have about what gods might look like, or some divinity might look like, or some higher race of beings. And so I saw they were all costumed to look like they were some sort of super, like Superman and Batman and these superheroes, like they were some sort of different race of people than just humanoids, you might say. And they tried to, and actually, also I saw they were wearing padding, all sorts of padding in their costumes to make them look really powerful and imposing. And I was kind of laughing at this. I says, what are you guys? You're just normal people. What are you doing? You look like you're going to some, you're putting on some costume play or something. It's ridiculous. But they've been working out in gyms very extensively. They were in super good shape physically. And also cosmetically, it seems like the people put a huge emphasis on makeup and cosmetics to make them look blemish-free. I didn't, you know, in cosmetic surgery, I could see they'd undergone all sorts of, you know, cosmetic situations, cosmetic adjustments to make themselves look like they were really, really beautiful and symmetrical and in great shape. I mean, there's like idealistic humanity, like ideal humanity, but they're dressed up in these rich costumes and costumes that made them look like they were like, you know, semi-divinity demigods and demigoddesses. They absolutely were. But I saw through it and I said, well, you're just people, you're normal people, but you're putting on this big act here. Well, again, if you're the elites coming out from underground after a period of time underground, and you know you're going to meet people on the surface most likely, how do you want to, first impressions are very powerful, how do you want them to view you? You want to make a very strong first impression when the people go, oh my gosh, the gods have come to save us. And then you're giving them this, help re-civilize them. They will say, these are divine gods and goddesses, they're divine, we will do whatever they say. And then you may also want to set up this idea that you're somehow separate and on a different level and you cannot intermingle. Now, there's something in history that's very important. Like they say, the Watchers came to this world and eventually they began mingling with the women of this world and having children, and that was supposed to be very taboo. You have this also, this myth throughout history that aristocracy, the royalty came from divinity, and you could not marry into that and you could not have children with the two levels of humanity were not supposed to mix or even unmixable. And if they tried to, you'd be struck dead. So the elites set up the system where you didn't even think about trying to enter their society. It was like either naturally impossible or there was a great divine taboo against it. So they want to come out and show the people, we are fundamentally superior to you, and don't even think about marrying into us or having relationships ever. You're here to serve us. You're our slaves. You're our servants. And that's the highest you can possibly aspire to. They don't want the slaves thinking they can aspire and, you know, have children and marry into these people at all. And, you know, the ancients were surprised, like, that they could have children with these elites or something. They said, wow, we didn't think it was possible. Well, you could understand that if the elites come out from underground, they may want to set up this hierarchy and claim that it's impossible. And then when people find out it's possible, people are like astonished. You're like, oh my gosh, that's really weird. It's amazing. And maybe part of the story of the virgin birth of Jesus, for instance, and Jesus wasn't the only story of virgin birth. There's many stories of that. Padmasambhava was supposed to have come out from just a lotus flower in a lake. No parents at all. As possible, he just appeared. But the idea is that there's no real human father, or there can't of these elite divinity. It can't happen, you know, in a normal way. So it's sort of telling people that, you know, you can't really intermingle your genetics with the elite. It's not possible, right? There's something like that. It's a control thing. So you look out throughout history and you realize this has been a big issue of the genetics and control and who can marry into what class of people, and this is very, very, very intense throughout history. And seeing this costuming that the people came out in, I feel they're very much trying to give the impression that they were fundamentally different than the people on the surface, even though I could see that they weren't different. So again, you're underground, what would you do? You know, you'd focus on your appearance, on your science scientific studies. You'd probably be a workout nut, and you realize you're going back to the service. You want to be in really great shape. You might get into a lot of fashion. How do you make yourself look more powerful and more authoritative? And all this stuff would be reasonable expectations. I mean, so this is what I saw. And so just plugging this all together, I say, wow, it's very reasonable to expect this. This is what's going to happen. And it seems like they were taking supplements of steroids of some sort to make themselves look, you know, more powerful, more beautiful, and maybe even larger, bigger. And they may have been doing some, I don't know, a lot of the elites are pretty tall and big anyway. And so it looks like they were trying to give the appearance of augmenting it. We know there are ways of dressing that make it look smaller and ways that make us look bigger. And if you take steroids and stuff, you can actually seem to be really bigger and imposing. And these people coming out from underground, they look that way, like tight ends, you know, football tight ends. I mean, they look like, you know, 6'8", and absolutely just rocking the physique. Plus, a very flawless physique, and they were tan. I mean, it's funny because they're all tan. Well, tanning booths. You ever heard of tanning booths? Of course. So underground, though, there's not much. You know, there's not the sunlight. They're going to want to appear like they just appeared from heaven. You know, so they don't want the people to know they came out from underground. If they came out from underground, the people might say, well, you should look, you know, pale and weak and all this stuff. But you're all tan and buff, and maybe you just came down from heaven, you know, which is a story they may tell the people. They may tell the people, oh, yeah, we just came down from heaven, and we're here as your rulers. Pretty convenient story to tell people who had their minds devastated by traumas, right? Very convenient story to tell. So you start plugging all this into a theory, and you're getting close to say you have a theory here. You're getting very close to it, really. And we're getting close to some sort of event horizon. There's no question about it. It seems to be an indication. I've gotten unbelievable push from the Holy Spirit about an upcoming event horizon. People are saying the Pope's going to resign in late May. Well, you know, wouldn't be surprised. May 27th. Wouldn't be surprised at all. Maybe the Pope's getting ready to go underground. You know, right? That's the least, you know, some rumors are drifting out there that he actually said he'd only serve for a couple of years and that would be it. So he's already laid the groundwork. Very interesting, because the Vatican is one of the places that has the most information about this. They have their own observatories. There's one in Arizona, was it called Lucifer or something? I mean, they believe that they're studying this incoming complex. So the Vatican has ancient records, just to be sure. So there is knowledge about all this in the Vatican. And so the Pope's saying, well, I only may be, you know, what Pope comes in and says, I think I'll probably only be Pope for 2 or 3 years. Well, that would put it, the Pope resigning right at the event horizon, pretty much so. Pretty much so, right? I can't remember when Francis, the Pope, came in. I don't know, when was it? Was it 215 or 214? But by him saying, well, a couple years, I'll probably be here a couple years. Well, that means he would be leaving the papacy right at this event horizon, which means you'd have to say he knows about it ahead of time. Has there ever been a pope in history who came into the papacy and said, you know what, folks, I've got to tell you right up front, I think I'm only going to stay for 2 or 3 years and then I'm going to resign? The answer is there's never been one who's ever said that. Okay? This has just gone black. The screen has just gone blank on me. Okay, that's why. There's never been a pope who's done that. So there just happens to be this Jesuit pope who has to be dialed in to deep knowledge of what the Vatican knows, who comes in the papacy and says, I'm only going to hang out for a couple years here, folks, and then I'm out of here. And this coincides with the Holy Spirit has shown to be the event horizon. How can anybody say that's just mere coincidence? I mean, that's powerful evidence right there. It's circumstantial, but you know, science has to deal with a lot of evidence that comes in that you can't say by itself it establishes a theory. But when you add it all up, it coalesces into a theory. And people are noticing this all over the world. They're noticing stuff and saying, hey, wait a minute. And why did Jade Helm, obviously an exercise that is planning for extreme public disturbance. Why the advanced preparation for what seems to be the belief that the public is just going to go crazy and they're going to need to be locked up and, you know, controlled martial law? There's already massive planning for that. People are aware of it. Why? Jade Helm seemed to be something that would indicate that they think that there's going to be a massive exodus from the East Coast. And there is concern that a space rock might come into the Atlantic Ocean, most certainly. Maybe near the Azores, actually. I got a tip for that. Somewhere, you know, out in the Atlantic by the Azores, there may be a space rock come in. And, some say near the Caribbean area, Puerto Rico or something. That could really impact the East Coast. The people flee from the East Coast towards to the West. And how are we going to get, you know, crack down martial law and then ship them off to places? You know, all this stuff, that there seems to be all this advanced planning in the world that isn't been able to be hid entirely. And you need a theory to account for it, right? Really? At the very least, hypothesis. We have a hypothesis. Incoming space rocks, possible incoming complex, Planet X Nibiru complex coming in. This would account for a lot of what is taking place in this world right now. It really would. You plug it in and then it just stuff starts making sense. And the advanced people have said that the elites have been aware of this for quite some time. And I say that the deep knowledge that the Vatican would know, it's very secret societies like the Masons would probably know, that has always been aware of it. The Egyptians aware, you know, that there's been a continuous awareness of this issue throughout history by the super elites. They've always kept it secret to themselves, but they have known about it, and they've encoded it in all sorts of ways in their architecture, in their art, and, you know, it's there. It's there. So the real insiders probably always known about it. Then there's another layer of insiders who probably found it on telescopes and stuff and realized that something's coming in. And then they went to the other people and said, hey, we have this evidence. What do you say? And they say, yeah, it's legit. And that's when, you know, a lot of the prepping of the elites really swung into high gear. You know, about how many has been 33 years ago or so, since 1983, 93, 103, 130, 33 years ago. It's been like 33 years that they've been prepping for it. Interesting. Jesus is said to have passed away after 33, the crucifixion of Jesus is said to take place in the 33rd year. Well, from 83 to now, it's been 33 years since they may have discovered this too. What we think of the crucifixion, and some say the crucifixion of Jesus is actually a symbolic event referring to this Planet X Nibiru complex coming in to this world and crucifying the planet. That Jesus stood for the planet, and this crucifixion stood for the planet being severely crucified, tortured, flailed, tortured, and then crucified. And then the resurrection of Jesus means that the planet will be reborn in another format. It will bounce back, and there'll be new life here on this planet. I mean, it could very well symbolize this whole thing, actually. Could very well symbolize it. And the cross, the use of the cross, that they say that this trouble comes from the Southern Cross, the area of Orion, I think, and the Southern Cross, and there's something to do with, or it looks like a cross that with the complex in the middle, and then the moons, the five moons around, but four strong moons looking like a very much like a crucifix cross, actually, sign of the cross. So there is this hypothesis that the whole story of the crucifixion is a symbolic situation pointing out to the crucifixion of this planet that occurs periodically. This is not to say that Jesus didn't go to the cross. He may have done that intentionally to bring it to our attention. That is possible too. See, both are possible, right? You can have both situations. So, you know, where there's smoke, you know, a lot of smoke, well, you know, you might want to poke around and see if there's some fire. You really, without being a fear-monger or anything, you're just looking at this and saying, you know, well, do we have a theory that accounts for all this weirdness, both throughout history and now? There's so much weirdness, but if you plug in this theory, hypothesis/theory, then suddenly the weirdness doesn't seem so weird at all. It seems logical, doesn't it? It certainly does. Now, how do we keep our calm? How do we keep our cool? Well, we know that their spiritual wisdom and grace that's aware of whatever our situation is, they're aware of it. And they are going to help us in some way. Now, I've certainly met some of these great teachers. They stress spiritual preparation. They stress this abidance is what it's called. And I've certainly been working on this. Today I got close. I felt I was, well, okay, what happened was, I had this insight where I suddenly realized, oh my gosh, that closeness is the self-deception. To say, I'm getting close, I said, okay, that's what we think. Okay, we're getting closer, real close. This itself is what has to be seen through as the deception. There's no such thing as closeness to what we really are because we're everywhere. We're here right now. How can we be close to ourselves? That is the duality. To say that what's close to us, the concept of closeness is the same thing as the concept of distance, actually. So you could say, well, I'm like 1 mile close. Just take it this way. Well, I'm 1 foot close. I'm 1 meter close. I'm 1 mile close. I'm 10 miles close. I'm 100 miles close. I'm 1,000 miles close to what I am. Right? Now, isn't that all the same issue of closeness? Does it really matter what label we attach to closeness? So let's look just at closeness. For what is it saying? What is it actually saying? Closeness. Forget about the labels of, you know, I'm 10 miles close, 100 miles close. Forget about that for now. What does close mean? What is close to inherent spaciousness, which is what we really are, what we're abidance is as inherent spaciousness. What could be close to that? Say, oh, I'm real close to that. What's close to it? It's everywhere. Inherent spaciousness is that seamless. It's everywhere. The idea of closeness to it implies, imputes, there's some distance. There's something else. It's not that. And this is the central delusion that we suffer from, that there's something other than what we are. And so we hide this by saying, well, I'm getting real close to what I am. Now, this is just a figure of speech. We all use it. Okay, I'm getting close. I've used it many times. We all use it. But we need to take a closer look at this and recognize this is the trouble. There's no such thing as closeness. So we could kind of humorously say, wow, recognizing there's no such thing as closeness, now we're really close, right? But this is close with a different meaning. It means we are getting the will, you might say, to recognize there is no such thing as closeness. But so when we say that closeness, we're saying, I really feel the will to awaken and recognize there is no closeness. I'm it. I'm not close to being it. I'm intrinsically it and always am it, and I never can be close to being it. That's impossible. That is the impossibility to say, I'm real close to being it. That's our self-deception. No, I am it. Is when we wake up, we realize, I am it. I'm not close to being it, and I never can be anything other than it. So, be aware of this, that there could be different meanings when we say, I'm getting real close. We could be saying, I feel the will there to recognize there's no such situation as closeness at all. And start spinning it in this direction, okay? Very important. So when I start plugging this non-dual teaching in, I feel very, don't want to say close, I say, but I feel very much my will being present to say, you know what, I will just abide in the way reality really is instead of a fantasy of closeness. I feel ready to drop this fantasy of closeness, which is really how we, if you want to say, how did we fall into delusion, is the fantasy of closeness. Say, I'm going to fantasize, I'm real close to you, God. That is, so quote unquote, the fall. Now, we've never really fallen because we're still exactly what we really are. But in our dream, the dream is a dream of closeness. It could start out as a dream of closeness. And then we begin playing with this idea of closeness. And then thinking that out of a duality, we could say, well, being like real close to God is godly, and being farther, not so close to God, is not being godly. So then we posited this false God of closeness by contrasting it with what we would say is not so close. You know, I'm only a foot away and you're a mile away, so I'm right and you're not right. You know, that kind of thing. I'm closer to God, you're far away, so I'm holy and you're not holy. We get into this whole complexity of the dream, don't we? The dream starts becoming very complex. Whereas a real awakening is to see that there's no such thing as closeness at all. All is it. Intrinsically it. All is inherent spaciousness and nothing else. There's not something that's distance close to inherent spaciousness. That too is in inherent spaciousness. Any closeness is also perfectly in the one inherent spaciousness. It's just ornamentation, just more ornamentation of its own inherent spaciousness. This is what Longchenpa, all blessings to the great Dharma, the Dharma King Longchenpa, points out. May his grace radiate into all minds always and awaken us. May the grace of this Dharma King awaken us always to this fact. To this great fact, and I believe his grace can awaken us to this fact. Absolutely. It's just a simple, it already did in my case for a brief period. And I just said, oh, I get it. That's easy. I see what the Dharma kings and queens have been talking about. This is what they've been talking about. Oh yeah, wow. Just like that. It's just inherent spaciousness. I saw the bird moving through the sky, and I said, but it's not moving in relation to inherent spaciousness at all. It's always like completely still in relation to inherent spaciousness. It never moves an iota out of it. There's no velocity of closeness or distance involved at all. None. Which, as Ramana Maharshi says, is absolute stillness, is God. Nothing is moving out of God. There's no dynamic at all of movement in relation to intrinsic spaciousness. Everything is always perfectly still in terms of distance or closeness or non. It's it. Everything is it constantly. So these are just sort of magical picture shows that are taking place. And there's a way of seeing it that you recognize this. And I've had this experience, so I know it's legitimate. I know it's very simple. Yeah, I was just like, oh, yeah, okay. It's like that. So that's easy. I said, that's so easy. It's so ridiculously easy. How come I didn't see that before? Because my mind was enmeshed in complexity of this closeness issue about and trying to basically, which is really a way to try to buy our freedom from reality. Say, hey, God, I'm real close to you. So that should buy my freedom from freedom. And these others, you know, they're far away. Because so you're trying to get the purchase price of freedom from freedom by saying to God, look, I'm much closer than they are. So I'm much more worthy to be free of freedom than they are. And the whole thing is a false parameter, a false setup, is a false, what do you call it, syllogism or some sort of false structure. Because there's no such thing as closeness at all. So how can you say you're closer and something's farther away when you've never left intrinsic spaciousness at all? And there's no momentum present at all. It's ridiculous. So we are getting to the core of it, the key, you know, the real core of looking at this issue of closeness. It's a false issue. It's a false issue. And we need to see it as such. And again, in awakening, it's just like just the next moment, you're just like, oh, of course. I see it plain, completely obvious. Nothing could be more obvious. And then at some point you start to say, well, why didn't I see it before? So just say you were, you know, trying to purchase your freedom from freedom by imagining complexity in the contrast and thinking that in this way you could generate, you know, this imaginary value, that you could gain value because you think you could use to purchase freedom from reality. But it was all just, you know, much ado about nothing, make-believe. Of contrasting labels, which in themselves have no meaning at all, and then imputing meaning to it. This is all just self-deception, as we've been engaged with, but we're so used to complexity that it's very difficult for us just to abide in the sheer simplicity of recognition. It's just all easy. You just say, oh, this is so obvious, completely obvious. I don't have to think about it at all. So thoughts are only necessary for complexity. You see, thoughts are like closer, you know, and farther away. It says, okay, this is closer, this is farther away. There's a contrast. And then this is what reality doesn't need. We don't need that to see what's completely obvious, intrinsic spaciousness. We don't need that type of, you know, thought like that at all. It's self-evident. So those of you who are all concerned and worried, you know, just hear this and realize, hey, wait a minute. There's some stability. I feel there's some stability somewhere, isn't there? There's something I can recognize that will fundamentally flip the whole script on the whole cosmos, actually. And I may not be as vulnerable as I think I am, actually. And I may not even be a body at all. never have been one. And the body may just be this shadow play, just a light, a play of light of this silly little light play. And I actually may be able to just have, change the play if I want to, this way or that way, like Padmasambhava. Just it's okay. I'm just going to turn myself into light. All these pinwheels of beautiful iridescent light. He may have just appeared in that way in the first place. People says as it goes, he had no parents at all. He just appeared. Padmasambhava, I believe that means the lotus born, of the lotus flower, born of the lotus flower. I mean, the talk of Padmasambhava is quite extraordinary. What he did, I mean, he just laid on the miracles and behaved in a very miraculous way. That this surface consciousness, whatever this is, he didn't seem to. He only followed it when it seemed appropriate. And the other times he didn't follow the laws, so-called laws of this dream at all. He says, "Okay, we need to travel a couple thousand miles. Let's go." And we just, you all just fly there, instantly, real quickly. He just seemed to realize that this is just a dream. And then imparted this knowledge to us of how to wake up from the dream. And of course, others have done so also throughout history in various ways. And so we may be really knocking on the door now. Well, not maybe, we are. We are knocking on the door, more than knocking on the door. We've identified, let's say we've really identified what you might say is a very core, important issue here about closeness. Drop the whole issue of closeness entirely, this whole notion of closeness. I believe if you just let go of that, you'll be enlightened. You will be enlightened. We will be enlightened. We will just see then, obviously, everything is just immediately present. It's the realization of what you might say presence. People who have done, there are those who have done this, and more than we realize, maybe, but not a large percentage. But it's just immediate presence. That's what's there. That we just the grace of the guru we just has helped us out, and we just say I'm just abiding by the grace of the guru who has somehow just really helped us push this whole notion of closeness. Just it's like a little distant cloud. If we want to entertain it at some point, we can again, but we're really not interested in this, in entertaining this little game of closeness and contrasting of labels. And we don't know what our will is and our disposition in terms of saying, okay, I've had enough of this folly of closeness. We may have in our mind, we may say, you know what? I can do that right now. We could do it right now, we could do it today, tomorrow, next day. But I felt today like, wow, why not? I started to feel like, hey, why not? Why not go ahead and do it? Seems like a good time to do it, doesn't it? So don't worry if you use the term closest, because what you might be saying is, I feel I'm getting close to dropping the notion of closeness. All right, so there's two different levels of meaning of that. Meaning my decision is nearing in terms of, window. It's like a dreamer deciding, I think I'm right about to wake up from this dream. They're still kind of dreamy, but they're also getting close to waking up. The dream is always just a decision away from vanishing. It's always just a moment away, a decision away. It's inherently that way. So what we say is, I think I'm about ready to make that decision. So we use the term quote unquote close, but this is a different way of using the term, the word close. Instead of saying, well, I'm close to God, I feel like I am close to God, in a close relationship with God. I think I'm getting closer to what I am, closer. It means I think I'm nearing a decision to wake up, to drop the whole notion that closeness is even possible. How can we say I'm almost where I am? Already am. I'm almost there as far as my own intrinsic spaciousness. This is a complete absurdity. I've almost arrived at where I am right now. This is what we're saying, you know. I'm really trying to get to where I already am right now. But how do I do that? I have to jump out of myself and jump back, but I got to do it so fast that I somehow lose intrinsic spaciousness by jumping over here. But when I jump over here, I still have intrinsic spaciousness, and I jump back, I still haven't. I haven't seemed to quite, you know, be able to figure this out. Well, that's because there's nothing to figure out. It's impossible. How can we figure out the impossible? What are we all these computers doing, trying to figure out the impossible? This is ridiculous. You know, how do we get free of intrinsic spaciousness? You don't. There's no algorithm for it. You don't. Nothing does. You cannot. Doesn't matter. The warping of time-space is still an intrinsic spaciousness entirely. Everything. All is. So this is just, you know, we're just hearing this and getting more and more familiar with it. So it's like, oh yeah, okay, familiar with that. And we're hearing, you know, about the bigger picture here in the world, the context here, and this is helping us out. We should be, I feel like I'm kind of feeling better and better about it all, actually. At the same time acknowledging it's quite intense. It's quite intense. You can feel it. You know, I'm shaken kind of today, and it's like, wow, something's really hit me very intensely. Because we're having to tackle this and put it all together. But we are. So all grace of the Guru be upon everyone. Whatever that Guru may be, wherever you feel that grace is coming from, or you know, the center, not the center, but the push of this grace, you know, the presence of this grace. It's capable. I think it's very capable of giving us this resolve. Just, we just have this, it's just this resolve somehow is just there. I can't account for it in terms of closeness. Because the ego always says, well, before you were awakened, you know, how close were you? This is what always will ask you. This is what essentially the ego will ask you. This is what pulls you back into delusion. If you try to answer the ego's question, is like, well, how close were you? And you have to say, well, there never was any closeness. I recognize that closeness was never true. And the ego said, but how close were you to recognizing this? And again, in terms of what the ego's playing a trick on us, because it's using this word that we think it can have two different meanings, but it does uses level confusion to flip the meaning on us, to flip the script. So once you get in a dialogue with the ego, at some point it flips the whole script, definitional script on you. And then closeness, it says, well, you said it was close, and so you can't be asserting this and this. And before you know it, it's got you trapped in its box of definition. It's very, very vicious and insidious this way, the ego. So it will keep jousting with you over this issue of closeness. It always wants to know, well, what did you do just before enlightenment? How, you know, I want to see how can I get close to enlightenment? The ego's very interested in getting close to enlightenment. It's obsessed with it, because this simply reinforces its whole delusion that there's some distance in the first place. The distance is possible. The ego lives on the idea of distance from God, separation from God, some distance. Without that, there's no ego. So of course it's going to be insistent on, well, you know, what did you do? Where were you? How did you, you know, where were you before you realized you were always exactly, never left where you can't leave you where you are? Where were you before that? I said, well, obviously I couldn't have been anywhere before that, because the realization is I can never leave intrinsic spaciousness. So it was just simply a wishful thinking that was never true. So there can't be the level that the ego's using closeness, where were you, is absurd. Actually, I was just in a state of temporary denial of insanity, trying to believe it was possible to be somewhere else other than where I, to be close to myself, which I realized it was just insanity. But the ego will always try to create some sort of definitional, verbal, symbolic distance, which is why there's this trouble in trying to communicate this, and how you can get really entrapped when you're talking to the ego, that the ego gets really mad at some point. It seems very reasonable, because it wants to engage you, but then it will flip the definitional level script of definition of what close means and what you're talking about to into its definition, and then it will think that you're just being very rude and mean and ignorant and stupid in your arguing. That it's being very logical, and you're the one suddenly is saying, wait a minute. And so it tries to take the high ground. It's just a very, very clever, vicious infighter in this way. And so this is why the non-dualists have to talk in a certain way, that, you know, it's just they're patient, but they keep reasserting the truth, you know, and the ego never gets it. Because if the ego got it, there'd be no ego. And not only that, they realize it never has been. So, of course, the dream of an ego has to keep positing that there's this distance, some sort of distance, has to. So the ego will never accept, you know, an explanation from anyone, never. It will always play these games, mind games, definitional games. So this is why I say that you have to listen in the mood of repentance and not allow the ego, full stop in the wow, doesn't allow the ego to start talking. There's no dialogue here with the ego. Like, well, you know, how did you do this? Do what? I didn't do anything. I just realized that nothing can be done. I'm inescapably it. I just accept. I just got caught. God caught me. So you might say, well, God caught me. The grace of the guru caught me. It just caught up with me. You know, so that's like, what more can I say? I just couldn't outrun it. So this is one way of saying I just couldn't outrun it. The ego say, well, what were you doing? I said, well, you know, it's irrelevant because the bottom line is I couldn't outrun it. It caught me. That's the bottom line. Well, why quibble about what was I doing beforehand? Obviously, whatever I was, it didn't work, and which is a good thing. So why would I be talking about what was I doing? You know, that's not the issue at all. It's not an important issue at all. But for the ego, it's all important. So the ego will engage you, but it has its own agenda of what's important, and it comes out sooner or later. It comes out. And you could tell if somebody is really listening from the standpoint of the ego or a repentant mind. There's a difference, a big difference. The ego says, well, there's no difference. You know, well, there is. You can't tell the difference. Oh, sure you can. Sure you can. So the ego thinks that you're not there unless you realize where you were before. Because you said, well, you couldn't have the realization then unless you arrived at where finally you succeeded. But the ego is thinking about its own success of returning, getting back to where you are from somewhere else, which would prove there is some source somewhere else. So that's what the ego thinks is enlightenment. No, that's not enlightenment at all. That's egoic delusion, which would, if that was the case, it would prove reality isn't real and the ego was right. So you don't get back to anywhere. You just realize all your dream efforts to run away from yourself were just a dream. You never left yourself. You can't leave yourself. You cannot leave intrinsic spaciousness. And you just said, I'm tired of just, you know, dreaming of what is intrinsically futile. What's the point of it, really? It's just stupid. So would you say, well, how'd you get to that? Well, what do you mean how I got to the point where I see it's all stupid? Well, it's just a complete accumulative effect of all this futility and stupidity. You know, it's just the scales are just, you know, the scales tip. And to say that's one thing that did it is to deny all the other stuff that's on the scale too. If you put all these grains of sand on a scale, at some point the scale tips if it's raining against something. You can't say that the final straw, the final piece of sand was the key that tipped it. That's stupid, because it's all the other grains of sand are just as key. If they weren't there, it wouldn't tip either. So the ego tries, you know, to play these mind games with you. Hey, nice little cricket. Hi, cricket. Which is why it's a good idea to be quiet when you're listening to someone who really knows what they're talking about. Don't let the ego get started on all this stuff. Because it gets real nasty the more further it goes. So full stop on the wow is the right practice. Get used to just no ego involvement at all. Just get comfortable with that. We don't need to call upon the ego to mess with our minds. Because if we call upon it to mess with our minds, it will mess with our minds. This is unquestionably so. And so instead of trying to defeat the ego, just say, ah, ego, you know, maybe I'll call upon you a little lot later, but not right now. Like that. And just let it go. I would say this is the best advice. Don't joust with the ego. You're going to lose. At the best, it'll try to drop a stalemate. So you just say, hey, ego, I call upon you when I want to be confused and fall away from abidance, but right now I'm not really ready for that at this point, so maybe I'll call upon you later. And then just stay in abidance like that. How are we doing here? Pretty good. Wow, we're cruising along, aren't we? And this another lovely summer day in California in April. Had like 4 days in a row, I think it's been, where it's just been off the charts. Gorgeous. Wow. Supposed to rain though Thursday coming up a little bit. Hope so. The creeks, everything's dry again. The drought is still on ferociously, folks. It hasn't ended. It was just, you know, there's some runoff for a while, but it's dried up now. So we could use a rainy May, I'll tell you that. And whatever we could get, an inch here, an inch there, just keep piling on. There's still some snow up above 7,000 feet, but a lot of below that is already melted. And ski season's over now. All the places have shut down now, pretty much so. And it's still, you know, April, so it's not like there's a massive snowpack going into late spring at all. And this cricket seems to think that this is real close, this cricket. It's amazing. I've never had one this close. It seems to think that things are heating up. Hello, cricket. Serenade us, absolutely. We could use your little serenade here. So again, I beseech everybody with good reason to just, you know, back away from upset and agitation and all that. And just say, hey, you know, well, let's see if we could use the resources we have. Let's see if we can just let the mind calm down a little bit. Not in just denial, but just pragmatically. Say maybe we're in a little better situation than we realize. Maybe we could just say, yeah, I can tackle this sort of dilemma that we've had about the ego and closeness, and there's techniques to succeed, and I could do that. I could just say, not now, ego, later. I mean, this is just as good as some Vajrayana technique, isn't it? Or better, really. I mean, this just not now, later. You don't try to get rid of or attack or struggle or defeat or anything. You just say, I know why you're coming, ego. I asked you to come. Take responsibility for your dream and the defenses of your dream. And you say, yeah, I know you're coming here because I'm feeling a little jittery because of a familiarity problem. So I've identified that's a familiarity continuity issue and not really an intellectual issue at all. So I really don't need any dialogue. All I need is full stop in the wow. So I don't need you now, so I'm not going to entertain you. But maybe later I'll call upon you. It's possible. If I need you, I'll call upon you. You know, I know you will, you know, appear, of course, because I called upon you. And then you can interject confusion at that point, but not right now. So if we just take this kind of very mellow attitude, it's very important. Maybe later, but not now, full stop in the wow. Maybe later, not now, full stop in the wow. Just practice this. And just take it to heart and have faith, you know, this works, this will work for us. Then, you know, when the agitation comes, just say, oh, agitation, not now. Maybe later, but not now. Full stop on the wow. Hey, the cricket stopped when I said that. Maybe this cricket is a devotee. What are you doing, cricket? As soon as I said full stop on the wow, you stopped. Now you started again. come on, cricket. Yeah. Maybe this is grasshopper, right? Coming here. Kung Fu grasshopper. I'm digging the vibes of this little noisemaker, little cricket. It's so close. It seems friendly. And maybe this is the issue of closeness. It's trying to say something about that. He says, no, I'm not close. I'm here. Is the cricket close to me, or is it here? Is it in the here-ness? Is it in inherent spaciousness where I am too? Are we really in different places? Are we both in inherent spaciousness? So, just to be comfortable, say, hey, I can consider this. This is like putting yourself in the court of the Dharma King, is it not? And the grace of the Dharma King is quite exceptional. Let me point out again to everyone that Sri Sri Anandamayi, quote unquote, Maha, was stupendous at relocating her devotees, though in the court of the Dharma Queen, those in the court of the Dharma Queen, to safe places that avoided the troubles of the partitioning of India, and then later the War of Independence of Bangladesh with Western Pakistan. She was astonishingly adept at it, really. And it was all accomplished, except for those who insisted on staying, you know, for their own spiritual ambition, you might say. And she warned them. She said, this won't go well for you. And they said, we don't care how. If we die for it, we die for it. That's okay. Okay, well, there are those who have this attitude in the world. You know, I'm willing to die for it. I'm not going. Well, you'd have to, you know, question why put your faith in that sort of loyalty and not in the faith of the grace of the Dharma Queen or King. You know, what are we putting loyalty in? Maybe the ego, right? Maybe the ego. The ego would love for us to tough it out and get this whole issue of closeness and distance. Well, I'm closer to safety or farther away. Whereas if we go to a place where there's no problems at all, this issue doesn't arise. I feel safe here. I feel safe here. I'm always feel safe. I mean, you feel safe. I feel safe. Whereas if there's all this scarcity and trauma and everything, people say, well, I'm closer, you know, to the food source and you're farther away. And there's all this, you know, scarcity. This brings up this whole issue of closer, right? Whereas if everybody is just taken care of inherently so, which we all are really, we could do that. Another thing, again, the great Dharma Queen stressed was, she basically said, look, the universe or whatever, the grace of God, reality, just takes care of you inherently. You don't need it. You don't have any needs. How could there be a need? She said, that means that that God's not taking care of you? This is ridiculous. She said, I only appear to have needs because so you feel comfortable with me. But she says, really, I don't have any needs at all. I don't need to sleep. I don't need to eat. I don't have any needs. Don't even need to breathe. I mean, God takes care of all of us perfectly, except we're pretending to be separate from God. So how can we then appear to be taken care of by God? You see, so we have all these so-called needs. She said, that's true. That we were imagining all these needs we have. We don't really have them at all. God will take care of all of us perfectly. So if we go to a place of reduced intensity zone, we may feel everybody there is just like being taken care of wonderfully. So there's no issue of I'm closer to the power structure, I'm closer to safety, I'm farther away from it, you know, I'm closer to danger. There's none of that egoic fear complex involved. You see, this is what we want to get away from, is this egoic fear complex. And so we want to practice, I'm perfectly taken care of, always. There's those assertions like, I can be perfectly taken care of, I will be perfectly taken care of, I am already perfectly taken care of, everybody can be taken care of. Everybody will be perfectly taken care of. Everybody is being perfectly taken care of right this instant inherently. All quote-unquote needs are being instantly met right now. No one is needy. No one is disadvantaged. Nobody can experience the slightest need. Nobody can experience the slightest disadvantage. Now, we're like when you're in a place like a beautiful desert valley with beautiful golf courses and you're out there, you know what? You feel like everybody's seeing this beautiful view. Wherever they are on the golf course, you're seeing gorgeous scenery and views. And so I feel like nobody's being disadvantaged out here. And you get this feeling like you see somebody, and it's like you feel, hey, I feel friendly towards them. They feel friendly towards me because you know what? When you're not being disadvantaged in the way, guess what? You feel friendly towards others. Why not? Why shouldn't you? Because they see too. They're not like trying to get something from me because they're not being disadvantaged in any way. Their needs, scenic needs are being met. I know they are, and mine are too. And you feel like brothers and sisters out there, really. You really do. I mean, you don't feel strange at all about coming up to somebody at AA and smiling. You're like your long lost friend out there, and you've never met him in your life, because you know they're not feeling disadvantaged at all. And so there's not this fear or competition, like, hey, maybe you're getting more than I am, and how can I get more than you are, you know, whatever. That's not present. It's really not present. And you feel this big, big difference of like just a sort of intrinsic friendliness. This is what we want, this feeling of intrinsic friendliness. The saints have this because they don't feel any disadvantage at all. And they don't see other people being truly disadvantaged at all. It's just they're pretending not to be, but they realize they're not really. So the saints are so friendly, is like they feel like, I can never ever feel disadvantaged or needy at all. It's impossible. So what do I have to fear? I don't think I'm not afraid. What do I have to fear? There's nothing to fear, is there? So going to a reduced intensity zone, sidestepping catastrophes, is just a way of really getting into the familiarity with our natural being, which is the natural being of all. That cricket has stopped now. Maybe listening, say, I like this. Listen real carefully. Now, when you go into a place that's ugly and you feel kind of nervous, like it's like, you know, how can I get advantage here? You're looking for some sort of advantage. But when you go to a place that's really gorgeous, after a while, you just say, you know, every place I've been on this golf course is gorgeous. I could just wander here anywhere. It doesn't really matter where I go. And so you stop worrying about advantage and planning and strategy. I really, you get the feeling at some point it hits you. It says, I don't care. I'm not lost. I can wander anywhere, and I'm not lost. I'll be exactly where I want to be, because I'll be surrounded by gorgeous scenery. I don't feel lost in the slightest bit, and so you get this feeling like I could just drive my golf cart anywhere, and who cares? I don't care what fairway I'm on or what hole I'm on. It doesn't really matter. It's all gorgeous. So I feel good. I'll feel good anywhere. So this whole complex of planning and strategy, and maybe I'm going to be lost, and you know, it just starts to dissipate. Dissipates. Naturally, just like evaporates. And then you feel like I can just sit here, and you're not afraid of people. You say, whoever comes up, you know, I'll just wave, and they'll wave to me, and they'll smile at me, and I'll smile at them, because they got the same feeling. They'll realize, you know, they're not causing me any disadvantage at all. I could go anywhere too. I mean, wherever we go, we're seeing this, you know, we're so happy here. So, hi, you know, this is great. I think a lot of religious people, Christian people who have built these country clubs and golf courses and stuff for retirement to get ready for the afterlife. They feel this is the way the afterlife is going to be. And they're, you know, they're not far away from that. The afterlife can be like that for sure in certain ways, yeah. That's not the ultimate, you know, you don't all that's not the ultimate. You don't get ultimately free from this notion of closeness or distance, but you certainly feel a lot freer. You could, but this you can still have this feeling of deprivation, that you know, that you still want to purge yourself from purchase freedom from absolute freedom. So you haven't really worked it through, but it is true that these really beautiful private golf courses, the people they wave, hey, how are you? And it's like you feel happy, 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 like you're in happy land. The Indians call it happy hunting ground, and your attitude is very different, very different. And those that have the money to live there, you know, they as they get older, they eventually pass away. People say, oh, it's beautiful. They seem so happy. Like I said, don't worry, I'm going to a place like this, only better. Yeah. It's true. You get out there and you really have these epiphanies of shifting in your attitude, where you don't feel paranoid about people anymore. What could they do? They tell you, "Well, I want you to move over there." Oh, sure. It's like, yeah. So you move over there and say, "Oh, wow. I get a new perspective of beauty. That, thank you. That's fantastic." And they say, "Well, hey, I want you to move over there." "Oh, sure. I'll move over here." "Oh, thank you so much. I'm so grateful because now I see a different vista. This is wonderful." You can't lose. You can't lose. And so the people out there, they can't lose either. So if everybody's in an I can't lose situation, where's the hostility? And you will find the hostility just doesn't seem to be there. Where did it go? Well, there's no ground for it really anymore. Because I wasn't asking for it. It only arises when we insist upon it. So I just dropped my insistence. There isn't any other cause. The ego says, "Well, what other cause? I mean, what led to that?" Nothing led to it. It was always there. It's always been just my insistence. So the ego's trying to find some causation other than us just desiring it to be there. There isn't any other causation. And the ego can never accept that, of course, but there isn't any other causation. So, I mean, let's head for the golf course, folks. I know some good ones, If I had the money, I'd buy into one, really. I know some ones that they're looking for, just membership. You buy into it, and holy cow, you just spend the rest of your life there, and you're ready to ascend. I mean, I've been on a golf course. I'm ready to ascend right now. I was in this one place. I was ready to go. I said, "I'm ready. Let's go to a be a more better place right now. Let's go to a reduced intensity zone. This is like a wormhole. It's almost like you can open up a wormhole, actually, to tell you the truth." People talk about wormholes and how to go to different places. They're starting to discover it. We could create our own wormhole just through our intent. Just our intent maybe is what does it actually. We just decide, hey, I'd rather be in a place where there's no, we realize nobody can be deprived of anything. That's where I want to be, and this will open up a wormhole to go to a reduced intensity zone. I had a dream where I simply drove my car there because I decided I was going to go there, and it could be I just went through a wormhole. What they call it, a wormhole. You just somehow you don't need space and time anymore to get you there. See, this is just a dream. We can change the dream. We could just decide, hey, you know what? In order to go to this place over here, I don't really need space and time involved to slow me down. I can be there right now. In the whole dream, you're just there right now. That's like in the dreams where I changed my dreams. It didn't take time to shift the dream. I may have said take it a little time, but the whole thing just tilted and boom, it was like that. What you would think would take a long time and effort just happened like that, snap of the fingers. So we could just decide, you know what, this is what's better for, this is what's really indicated for us. And we understand that the whole fear, hostility thing has to do with the idea of a disadvantage and needs. Well, we realize those are all just completely made up. And that by going to a place where we don't have any needs or disadvantages and we feel just impossible, that all this fear and hostility and unfriendliness, everything, that'll just disappear for us. We don't need to get rid of it by defeating it intellectually, but just by not having any feeling of disadvantage for anyone. So it's not just me, it's the others have to feel no disadvantage either. Otherwise, I feel they may come after me to get my advantage or something, or try to maneuver me out of where I am. But if everywhere is gorgeous and beautiful, people are friendly. Guess what? They're friendly. They really are. They're happy. They're not worried about you. "Oh, here comes somebody. Maybe they're going to get what I have." What do you mean? They've got what I have right already. They've got the beauty already. So we may just decide that's the right step to take, and then boom, we can go there just easily. We're just there. And since we don't have any need or disadvantage, we can't possibly suffer any sickness or trouble. Our environment automatically is exactly what it needs to be to make us feel like we're totally welcome there without any deprivation or needs at all. It's all a dream anyway. The idea is that, well, how are you going to go somewhere for the right kind of atmosphere for your bodies? Because that's what we decide is. We decide the atmosphere is not going to give us any trouble at all. We're not going to feel any deprivation whatsoever. And therefore, the dream atmosphere, which is what all this is, actually a dream, it simply immediately is that. It simply is that, just like that. We're the dreamers of the dream. Dream is not dreaming us. We're dreaming the dream. So we can decide, what the parameters of the dream, how it's going to be. Is it going to affect us like we're disadvantaged or threatened or anything or not? So it's up to us. It's up to us. That's why you have these gurus. Somebody comes along and, you know, hacks their head off, and the guru that just kind of reaches over, picks their head up and puts it back on, or their arm or something. I mean, these are these really mahasiddhas or something. I'm not recommending just trying to do this. But they said, well, you want to see me, well, you know, with my arm hacked off. Okay, I don't care. You know, you want to see me as deprived and disadvantaged, you know, and thinking that empowers you or something. Okay, I'll let you, but now I'm going to teach you a lesson. And well, I'm just going to grab the other arm with my other, and just, you know, put it back on, reattach it, and everything's fine. I'm not disadvantaged now in the slightest, am I? And that's when the devotee goes, oh my gosh, you know. Shocks them, you know, but these are stories that may have happened in various places. it's very possible, right? It's all just a dream, but you have to be perfectly aware it's all just a dream to do this. Yeah, so Jesus said, don't tempt yourself in that way, you know, don't show off in that way. There might be just a particular instance where some mahasiddha or something does that for some devotee to just to wake them up or something, you know, but it just illustrates the situation. That, so, we could easily go to a reduced intensity zone, and it's just going to be perfect for us. It's going to be beautiful for us. There's not many enemies out on a beautiful golf course, let me tell you that. I only had one time where someone really acted out. It was interesting. It was, guy was having a tough life, and the times of those times and whatever, he was so frustrated and got in some entitlement mode. And I understood it. And he just, you know, they almost got in a fight, and he stormed off the course. Other than that, I've never really seen anything, actually. I don't think so. It's very rare. Well, you got that one guy bellowing at me. He wanted to play through. He was just in such a rush, but. And but when he passed me, he said, do you mind if I play through? I said, oh, sure, go ahead. So it was all fine. You get some people who are in a rush these days. But you know, like a private country club, you wouldn't get that kind of thing. You'd say, want to play through? Fine. I'm in no rush. No. Well, I'm not, you know. Or if I want to play fast, I'll play fast. Or whatever. It doesn't, you know, mostly people are in a good mood. They really are. I mean, how could you not be, really? You've probably got everything you want to eat and drink, and you're in this nice little golf cart, takes you wherever you want to go, and you're in this gorgeous countryside, and you know, maybe they miss, you know, just not working, and you're just kind of just having a good time, being amused by what your golf ball does. You know, it's pretty amusing, the various places it can go. You say, I wonder where it went this time. You know, you find, you say, ah, son of a gun. You know, isn't that interesting that it ended up there and not there? And I remember I hit a shot to this par 5, the 18th hole, this one in the desert, and I hit a great shot. I said, wow, what a way to end the round. So I get up to the green, and I can't find my ball, and I'm looking for it for 10 minutes. I say, I can't believe this. Well, there was this lake right near the green, and there was this little finger of the lake that kind of got a little swampy, and it crept up a little tongue up into the right side of the green. And then there was a steep hill that just dropped off right into it. You couldn't see that from the fairway. It looked like you just had carte blanche to go to the green, you know. It was hidden. And I said, son of a gun, you know what? I think my ball rolled into the lake right there. I lost my ball. I was like, wow. I said, that was interesting. But still, the scenery is so gorgeous. I said, well, that gave me more time to just, like, walk around and enjoy the course. So I said, you know, two thumbs up. So you don't get mad. I didn't get mad. I said, oh, wonderful. I spent more time out here. Thank you. I still hit a great shot and got to enjoy it. And just a sneaky thing, that's called local course knowledge. If you know that there's a false front, tricky false front there to capture your final shot of the day and kind of try to ruin your round, but it doesn't ruin it. Doesn't ruin it. You get to listen to all the cicadas, everything buzzing a little longer. Then you go in into the shade, cool down, and order a lemonade, you know? Bottomless lemonade, drink some lemonade. Maybe eat a sandwich, calm down. So may everybody have the good life. You know, seriously, may all beings experience the Buddhists call it the pure lands. We call it a reduced intensity zones. A reduced intensity zone, Arizona, is sort of an acronym for it. May all beings experience these reduced intensity zone pure lands, where you just naturally become friendly and happy more and more and more, and the ego just dissolves. It's a funny thing, because I tell these people about these places, nobody follows up on it. I just find it so bizarre. I say, folks, I know where you can go, and you're going to be happy. You're going to feel it, and it'll get into you. It will get into you. They never go. They never go. They're still battling for, you know, advantage. My happiness has to do with getting an advantage over others. And Jesus' teaching clearly indicates this is not true. This will result in paranoia and defensiveness. The way to do it is go someplace where everybody is like being blessed by beauty and ease and comfort and whatever. And I'm happy, you're happy, and the paranoia begins to evaporate. Now, the communists are trying to enforce this on everybody, but this is an idealistic, you know, fault that they, the mistake they're making. It's a superficial understanding of the situation. You have to be spiritually attuned to the purpose of it all in order for it to really, you know, be of benefit. And you can't just communistically enforce, well, we're going to give everybody enough food and enough drink, and everybody has access to these things, equal access. That doesn't get rid of people's pride and desire to be separate from God at all. You have to repent first. You have to have a repentant mind to understand the direction this is putting you in. So this dream of international communism, you know, is like a sort of a foolish idealistic dream, which is not really grounded in genuine pragmatism and repentance. And in fact, it doesn't even acknowledge God at all. It's really designed to get us to just insist that this world is our home and that we are separate from God. That's what it's really designed for. In other words, we can give you the same happiness of the pure lands and reduced intensity zones if we just have this global communism here in this world. Well, guess what? It doesn't work remotely like that. It's hellish, actually. So don't fall for that at all. You know, we do acknowledge God. We do acknowledge our perfect perfection. We do acknowledge that there's no way to buy our way out of reality or freedom, and that we're inescapably it. And we do realize there's a path back to that, and we need to make sure that we wish, you know, truly wish all blessings upon everyone, because that's how it really is. If somebody is deprived, how can we feel safe? Because they're going to come after us. So, but I mean spiritually deprived, I mean truly. So by giving everything to everyone, how is anyone deprived? They can't be. So how can there be any threat anywhere? There can't be. No one can deprive anyone of happiness. No one can ever be disadvantaged. If you give everything to everyone, how can anyone be disadvantaged? So God gave everything to everyone. So where is their disadvantage? It doesn't exist. Where is their deprivation? It doesn't exist. All beauty to all. So where can there be, you feel like, oh, I'm so depressed. No, everyone has everything. So everyone is happy. No other way can be. And nothing is threatened. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. Our happiness cannot be threatened. Nobody's can. And there can't be this paranoia and fear. How could there be? Fear of what? Can't lose anything. How could we be afraid? We can't be deprived. So what basis could fear have? It couldn't have any basis except just sheer whim, which is what we really did, you know, just sheer whim. And sheer whim is nothing but sheer whim. It's not causative of anything, and it's not causative of deprivation at all. It's just sheer whim. So that's what we have been engaged with, actually, you know, or at least imagining, hoping that we're engaged with it. There's really nothing to engage with at all. There's nothing to engage with in terms of whim, sheer whim. We're getting pretty close to the end of this video, which is fine. It's an evening time here, and I got to get up pretty early tomorrow. I'm not really sure what I'm going to be doing tomorrow. I could have to do a lot of stuff I don't really look forward to, actually, as possible. So we're just going to let this video, you know, finish up here naturally. It reaches its conclusion. It'll reach its conclusion. Full stop on the wow, as I've said. The wow of no deprivation. Maybe not now, ego. Maybe later. Don't try to kill the ego. Just say, hey, ego, thanks for showing up. You always do when I call you. But right now, I'm thinking, you know, I'm just going to full stop on the wow right now and get used to this. I've got a little jitters, but I can get used to it. So maybe later I'll call you, but I don't need you right now. But thanks for showing up. And, you know, maybe we'll see you later. And you just have this very relaxed attitude towards the ego like this. Just have a thankful attitude that hey, look how in control I am of the dream. I asked the ego to show up and it showed up. I'm really in control of the dream, aren't I? Of my dreaming. Yeah, I certainly am. So that's it. Wonderful. So bless everything that's ever happened to you. Everything's been a blessing because everything that's ever taken place as you asked it to show up for you. And it did. Absolutely, it did. So you've always been in control. Isn't that great news? So when you tell the ego, not now, ego, later, you're in control of that too. So you can't abide because you're in control. So you can't abide. There's no dynamic preventing your abidance except you asking the ego to interfere with it. So if you can tell the ego, no, don't interfere right now, it won't. It doesn't have any power, actually, to interfere. We're the ones who have been in completely control of our own experiencing all along. So you might be listening and say, wow, I mean, this is like, I didn't realize how easy it was. I never thought I could hear it like this. It's so simple. I said, really? Yeah, it's really this simple. I thought there'd be all this esoteric stuff and I need to be chanting and doing my visualizing mandalas. And no, it's like actually just very simple like this. Not now, ego, maybe later. And thank Jesus for bringing in this streamlined simplicity. For sure he did. It really is just like this. And then just a wow of that. But say, not now, ego. I'm just going to get a little jitters about this, but I'll get used to it. I'll get used to it. So just remain calm, very relaxed and calm about it. Now, I already ate. I ate like at 6 o'clock or just some salad. I said, I'm not going to eat anything more. But I did make a kind of heavy salad. You throw cottage cheese in anything, it makes the salad too heavy, in my opinion. But I want to get my weight down. You know, come on. I tell a scullery boy, come on. You could give me something. Good reading, come on. It just like, doesn't want to. So I'm going to try and, you know, hopefully tomorrow morning I'll have some. I didn't eat much today, that's for sure. And maybe, you know, let's get that good reading on the scale for once. praying for it. It'd be nice, it'll make my day. It really will make my day if I'm so fortunate. But probably I won't quite get it. But maybe I will. I'm just looking for one number. I'm just looking for, just, you know, hit that.